Ma'am, I think it's 7:10. We can begin the session and I believe Vice Chancellor will also join in between.
Yeah, at the end of the program, last day, he wants to join.
वो तो सर क्या करेंगे वो तो
Sir.
Yes, Amit.
Nagin, we are starting.
Okay, sir, ma'am's profile data, I think I have sent your mail, sir.
Copy.
Still now.
Okay.
Namaste, sir.
Namaskar, ma'am.
Ultimately, with the God blessings, we are able to start.
Correct, correct. I agree with you.
And your cooperation.
Nein, nein, not at all, not at all. It's my pleasure.
Thank you.
Very good morning. Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, National Law University, Lucknow. It comes to all the students of all the National Law University, professional institutions, Institute of Communications of India, Institute of Accountants of India, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and all the members who are participating from different parts of 3-4 this program. At the outset, we extend our apologies for the trouble in technology that we were having in the beginning. We were supposed to start this program on 19th because of some technical glitches. We could not start the program on 19th. Now we are through with the technological challenges. We made the arrangement for making this program live on the YouTube channel of Law University. And the link is shared in the chat box also. And if any person is facing any difficulty in making a login on this particular LEDx platform, then one can alternatively log in on the new platform as well. Today we have privilege of our eminent speaker, Mr. S. Sudhakar, Vice President, Corporate Secretarial from Reliance Industries Limited. Vice Chancellor Dr. Subir Bhatnagar will be joining this session in the evening. We have a Professor Dr. Vishalakshi, who is a brainchild for designing this program and coming out with this wonderful thought of 15 days masterclass to bridge the gap between the academicians and the industry. That was the objective. So I will request Dr. Vishalakshi ma'am to first give the brief about this program, and then I will introduce the faculty, and then we will start the program.
Thank you, Mr. Amit Gupta. The resource person, Mr. S. Sudhakar. Program coordinator, Mr. Amit Gupta. And my dear participants from national level institutes, warm welcome to everybody. During lockdown period, physical classes have been suspended. As a result, UGC and MHRD have widely promoted online means of instruction. Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University has taken up responsibility to provide online classes on corporate law, online master classes on corporate law, with the objective of providing the students master classes with eminent speakers ranging from the Institute of Company Secretaries of India, Reliance, Madan Law House, DLF, SEBI, SEC Limited. Having regard to the importance and the complexities, topics are selected. Importance, for example, importance of online ADR process. Everybody knows of it. Disputes related to online transactions are on the rise with the rapid growth of e-commerce. The existing disputes redressal mechanisms are falling short of the business growth and the consumer expectation. Conventional redressal systems require the presence of the parties, which are not in sync with modern online platforms. The dire need and importance of online ADR process is acknowledged by the Department of Consumer Affairs, Central Government, when it planned to roll out an online consumer dispute resolution platform. Online Consumer Mediation Center, NLSIU, Bangalore, headed by Professor and Dr. Ashok R. Patil, that follows the best practices emerging in the global e-commerce arena. Another initiative called ODR Ways, started by the students of NUJS Kolkata, is working towards promoting mediation in India by integrating it with the technology. They have developed an online mediation platform for small civil claim disputes. In spite of the drawbacks linked with an online arbitration, it would be one of the most significant methods of resolving B2B, B2C disputes in the current era of digital India. Similarly, and the volume of litigation vis-a-vis operation and mismanagement, you know very well. So one of the aspects of operation and mismanagement is that, is there any possibility of arbitrating operation and mismanagement in India? Yes, in 2011, our Apex report in Boozy Allen and Hamilton versus SBI Home Finance Limited, the Supreme Court expounded the concept of arbitrability. Generally and traditionally, all disputes relating to rights in personam are considered to be amenable to arbitration, and all disputes relating to rights in rem are required to be adjudicated by the courts and the public tribunals, being unsuited for private arbitration. However, this is not a rigid or inflexible rule. Disputes relating to subordinate rights in personam arising from rights in rem can be arbitrable. Same position in England. In the same year, in 2011, the Court of Appeal in Fulham Football Club versus Sir David Richards, it was held that arbitrator could determine whether there had been unfairness or not, merely because there were certain reliefs which only the court could grant, such as winding up, would not mean that these cases were entirely outside the purview of arbitration. The parties had not to be prevented from arbitrating in the disputes alleging unfair prejudice. But in 2015, in Rakesh Malhotra versus Rajendra Kumar Malhotra, Bombay High Court rendered a judgment to the effect that all O&M petitions are outside the purview of arbitration, as the reliefs which can be granted by the tribunal under Section 242 of the Companies Act 2013 are of such a wide sweep which cannot possibly be granted by the arbitral tribunal. Where a petition related to O&M is filed seeking reliefs, some of which are in the nature of reliefs in rem and some in personam, it is not possible to sever one from the other. The only exception to this is when the O&M petition is malafide, vexatious, and dressed up one through clever drafting to hold out as a O&M petition. Only disputes relating to breach of agreements containing arbitration clauses in substance must be referred to arbitration. This judgment has been followed in 2016 in Siddharth Gupta versus Gated Info Services Limited, in 2011 Punita Kathar versus Explorers Travelers and Tours Limited, in 2019 National Company Law Appellate Tribunal in Dhananjay Mishra versus Vinetran Services, it was held that the acts of non-service of notice of meetings, financial discrepancies, and non-appointment of directors being matters specifically dealt with under the Companies Act and falling within the domain of the tribunal to consider grant of relief under Section 248 of the Companies Act rendered the dispute non-arbitrable, though it cannot be disputed as a broad proposition that the dispute arising out of breach of contractual obligations referable to the MOUs or otherwise would be arbitrable. Similarly, when it comes to anti-competitive agreements in public procurement, also volume of litigation, yes, we are observing as bid rigging, collusive bidding. When it comes to competition law, yes, combinations, abuse of dominant position, these topics are important. This program is spread over a period of 15 days, and topics means e-certificates will be awarded to the participants subject to the compliance of attendance requirement. I hope the master classes on corporate law, especially from the experts from industry, will be able to fill up the gap between academia and industry. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshi, for your opening remarks and the program theme. Now let me have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Vishalakshi. She is a bachelor's and master's from the Andhra Pradesh. She has been awarded the doctorate degree for her thesis state liability for a breach of contract. She has served as a lecturer in the DNR College of Law, Andhra Pradesh, National Law School, University, Bangalore, National University of Judicial Science, Kolkata. She has also served principal in the DNR College, Andhra Pradesh. And since then, she has been working with Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University at Lucknow. She is the head of Department of Legal Study. She has contributed numerous articles on the corporate law. And she has been contributing regularly for the Corporate Law Advisor, Company Cases, IUP Journal of the Corporate Governance, RM Law Journal, Supreme Court Cases, Supreme Court Journal and Andhra Law Times. And she has published several papers on the conference proceedings. She has participated in several roundtables. She has been author of titled as Government Concepts in the year 2014. She has been a panel participant of the panel discussion in the field of the corporate law. She has taken experience of almost more than 28 years. I'm sure her enriched experience will help us and benefit all the participants in the program designed by her for the benefit of all the students and the members, with the objective of bridging the gap in the academia and the industry, which is very vital to enable the new people to meet up to the expectations of the industry. Welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
The subject for the today's discussion.
Mr. Amit Gupta. Mr. Amit Gupta.
Yes.
Sir, Vice Chancellor has sent a message. I will read up.
Yeah, please. So I request Vishalakshi ma'am, because Vice Chancellor sir is not able to join. He will be joining maybe at late hours or maybe some other day in 15 days of time. I request her to read the message for the participants.
Yes. I'm reading up this message on behalf of the Vice Chancellor, Professor S.K. Bhatnagar. Good morning, all the resource persons and the participants. I deem it my privilege to get this opportunity to say a few words. I welcome the galaxy of experts who would be pouring their knowledge during different sessions of this course. I congratulate the organizers who have chosen this excellent theme for this course. It was because of the sub-themes of the course that so many participants have shown keen interest in joining this course. It is being conducted during a bit early morning hours, but this odd time slot has not dampened the spirit of the resource persons and of the participants. I believe there is going to be a very meaningful and fruitful interaction among all the attendees. The learning outcomes will be immense. I wish all the best for the success of this class. Thanks a lot. So I'm thankful to Vice Chancellor of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University and the program coordinator, Mr. Amit Gupta, for the wonderful arrangements he has made vis-a-vis resource persons, especially from industry. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you to Professor S.K. Bhatnagar for his kind words for this program. Let me have the privilege of introducing to Dr. S.K. Bhatnagar, Vice Chancellor, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University. Professor Bhatnagar has a long teaching and administrative experience. He has completed post graduation from Kurukshetra University and doctorate in law from Rohtak University, Haryana. He has worked in various capacities in Baba Sahab Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Lucknow. Some of the major positions he held were Dean of Law, Acting Vice Chancellor of University in the year 2001 and 2007. Professor Patnagar has served almost for four decades as a law teacher in the university department. He was also a member of First Academic Council of National Law School, Bangalore, in the year 1987. He has been nominated by the Chief Justice of India as a member of Executive Council of the Indian Law Institute in the year 2006. Based on his long teaching and research experience, he has contributed in many reputed institutions of national repute, member of academic bodies of Himachal National Law University, Assam National Law University, member of academic bodies of the universities at Delhi, Patna, Bhopal, Sirsa, Nainital, Halmahera, and Karnavati University of Gujarat. Professor Bhatnagar has published more than 36 of papers in the reputed journals. He has edited many books. He has been member of several editorial and advisory boards of the reputed journal. He has been invited to various All India Radio programs, and he has been sensitizing the society at a large on different aspects from time to time. We welcome you, sir, in absentia. Thank you for your kind words for motivating us, motivating the team of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia University, who has been working hard since last almost 15 days for making this program a reality. We will surely like to hear you personally as per your convenience. Now let me introduce the speaker for the day, Mr. S. Sudhakar. He is a Vice President Secretarial, Corporate Secretarial in Reliance Industries Limited, Mumbai. The topic assigned to him, the request he has made to deliberate on the dividend, investor education and awareness fund, there are such requirements we have to comply, and the most important, that is a key managerial personnel. Mr. Sudhakar is a fellow member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ICSA UK, and a law graduate. Having over 3.5 decades of wide spectrum of experience in the legal, secretarial, finance, and the account fields, he is working as a director in several companies. Prior to joining Reliance Industries, he has worked for about 15 years in the Berger Paints India Limited as a senior general manager of finance and accounts. He is presently vice chairman of Secretarial Standard Board of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India for the year 1920, and he has been member of the year 2016-17-18 of the Secretarial Standard Board. He has been member of the several committees of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India and several other institutes as well. He was a core member of the committee constituted for formulating the vision new ICSI 2022. He was part of the vision implementation committee also. He has been part of the several task force and the committees constituted by the ICSI. He is a regular faculty at the Institute of Directors. He has been a guest faculty at NPSM. He has been teacher and visiting faculty at various workshops, seminars, training programs, ICSI, ICWI, Association, PhD, and other chambers of commerce. And also, he has been regularly addressing to the students by way of taking the sessions in the MSOP program, SMTP program of Institute. He has written several articles on the corporate law, management, and the corporate governance to the professional journal. And above all, always approachable, though he has been holding a high position in the corporate, and I know how busy he is all the time. But he is always just a call away. He had told him last week also, he consented a single phone call come and address to all the students and the members. We are extremely thankful to you for speaking to our request and addressing to the students and the members today on this subject. The floor is all yours. I will request Vishalakshi also to please just mute your mic also. I will also mute my mic. And I will request Sudhakar sir to please start his deliberations.
Amit, I think you have to give me the share rights to share my presentation. Okay. Good morning, Amit. Good morning, Dr. Vishalakshi. And good morning, participants. At the outset, I express my sincere thanks and gratitude to Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, National Law University, the organizers, for inviting me to this morning master classes and to express my views on the given subject. At the same point of time, I congratulate the university for taking this excellent initiative of organizing this 15 days master class and inviting the industry experts so that the students and the participants can have the combination of a theoretical as well as the practical knowledge. I'm also delighted to know that Dr. Vishalakshi was connected with DNR College, because I was a student of DNR College then, long before. Whenever you come to know about somebody is connected to your roots, you will be delighted. So I'm delighted, ma'am, that you are from DNR College. I have a great respect for that college because I was a student of that college. With these words, let me share my presentation and take this subject of today. Able to see?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Friends, let me start my top subject with a recent LinkedIn quote for the benefit of the participants. Let me say that every day I put a quote on the LinkedIn, and these are all connected to the profession and the professionals. So within my limited ability and the experience, whatever at my disposal, every day I put one quote which will be helpful to the youngsters. So recently I put in one quote of mine in LinkedIn, that is, life will not be the same hereafter. Better to realize this bitter truth as early as possible and gear up to accept it and adopt it. This particular quote I have put in with a great responsibility after a great understanding of the present situation. We all know that we are passing through a very difficult times, but the great opportunities emerge out of great difficulties. This is, I strongly believe on this. Whenever I faced great difficulties, I could come out of that very successfully, and ultimately got benefited immensely out of it. Same is the case now also. Unfortunately, we were to face this lockdown situation. This is inevitable. But better minds and wise minds always look for the opportunities here. What we have to do is that when there is something inevitable, we have to accept that and we have to gear up to face that situation, and at the same point of time to turn that situation to our benefit and advantage. I'm sure that the initiative taken by Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University is towards this particular objective of mine only. So we all have accepted the bitter truth that now we have to live with this situation for some more time. And we have to gear up now. How to gear up? That is that we have to improve our skills, whatever we have, whether it is professional skills or academic skills or technical skills. Especially what we need to have is we have to improve our IT skills. If we say that, look, I am not an IT tech savvy person, it won't do in future. Organizations have to make good amount of investment in technology. They have to improve their hardware, software, everything. And the kind of situation what we have faced last week is a lesson to all of us that whenever we are in future, we have to live virtually only. Most of the meetings are going to take place on virtual platforms. So we need to make investment in this, and we have to improve our bandwidth wherever it is required. And similarly, the panelists who are coming also, they should be able to maneuver and they should be able to navigate through the web portals, whatever we have. In fact, 2 days before I was addressing in one forum, and there was a series of disconnects were there, and all with that, the participants and the faculty gets irritated. So this is one lesson we have to learn out of that is that we have to improve our technical skills towards, and at the same point of time, the moment you are having the technology, these advantages as well as disadvantages are going to be there along with that. Before taking up my subject, let me put a disclaimer that whatever the views I'm expressing are of my own and nothing belongs to the organization in which I'm employed. Similarly, Companies Act 2013 is a very complex subject in nature, and different people have different interpretations on, especially on different aspects. So that's why this presentation is to the best of my understanding of the subject. Before I take the subject, let me also just put one slide. I thought of putting it on the Companies Act 2013. Unlike Companies Act 1956, Companies Act 2013 is a forward-looking legislation. I won't say that Companies Act 1956 was not a forward-looking legislation, but the kind of the flexibility what that new act has been given, it is a very forward-looking legislation, and it focuses primarily on the good governance practices through disclosure-based regime. This act is more of a self-regulated act than of a regulated act, so our responsibility increases manifold. This act has taken several new initiatives like introduction of independent directors, woman director, resident director, and similarly, this board evaluation, key managerial personnel, so on and so forth. There are an empty number of new initiatives this act has taken, and it has substantially raised the bar of corporate governance as far as the disclosures are concerned. But the only problem is this was a very ineptly drafted and hastily implemented act. And because of that, it has become a very arduous and risky affair for both regulator as well as to the stakeholders to implement and interpret this act. Because of this, there were a series of circulars, notifications, removal of difficulty orders, amendment acts. Already we have 3 amendments, Companies Amendment Act 2015, 2017, 2019. So every alternate year, one or the other amendments are coming. And already Companies Amendment Bill 2020 is there before the Lok Sabha. Due to lockdown situation, that could not be taken up. In fact, in 2013, when this act was legislated, that point of time when I was addressing several forums, I used to say that, like Farah of the 1974, in my student days, we used to call it as a draconian act. And subsequently, it was replaced by FEMA. And like Farah, this Companies Act 2013 was a draconian act at that point of time. Why it was so? Because the word fine appears 189 times, penalty 41 times, prosecution 24 times, and imprisonment 76 times. The act was so so rigor. It was virtually created some kind of tremors among the professional circles as well as in the industry. So over a period of time, the regulator is diluting the act, and especially Companies Amendment Act 2019 had taken great initiatives to dilute the act, because the procedural lapses also, there were criminal penalties, were there, criminal penal provisions were there. To a large extent, the same are being taken care of. Even in Companies Amendment Bill 2020 also, some more new initiatives are there. Because of this, what happened is that, again, I borrow one quote from Alvin Toffler, that the illiterate of 21st century will not be those who can't read and write, but those who can't learn, unlearn, and relearn. When I was addressing in 2014 onwards on the subject of Companies Act 2013, I used to say that the order of the day is to learn the new act, Companies Act 2013, to unlearn the old act, and again to relearn the new act. This learning, unlearning, and relearning process, at that point of time, I have visualized for a period of 5 years, it is going to be there, and I proved correct. And again, I have another, what's called as, okay, I can say that this particular process is going to be for at least another 3 to 5 years going to be minimum. The way the changes are going, especially the future of India is going to be very bright, according to me, that a lot of industries are going to come, lot of new initiatives are going to be taken by the government of India. With all these things, we are going to have a golden era. In this time, what happens is that definitely the acts have to undergo several changes which are suitable to the ease of business, what the government is promoting day in, day out. So with this point of time, this learning, unlearning, and relearning process is going to be there for some more time. So we also need to develop this ability of learning, unlearning, and relearning. But we have to increase the pace of this also. That means we have to learn the things quickly. We have to unlearn the things also quickly, and we have to relearn the things quickly. So for example, this during this COVID situation, both Ministry of Corporate Affairs as well as SEBI have given several relaxations. They have taken all these steps very proactively, and they have given several relaxations. And all these relaxations are going to be only for a short while. So what happens? We have to learn this, because these relaxations, what have been given, is subject to certain rules and regulations. So we need to understand those rules and regulations, and we need to implement all those things. We need to comply with all that rules. And at the same point of time, as soon as their life is over, that means their periodicity is over, we have to unlearn that quickly, and we have to again relearn the existing provisions. So this particular thing is one of my messages to the youngsters to develop this ability. Now, the topic assigned to me is three subjects, that is the key managerial persons, dividend, and as well as IEPF. Let me take up first the key managerial person. This is a new concept which has been introduced as far as the Companies Act 2013 is concerned. Let us see the definition which has been given under Section 2, Subsection 51. Who is a KMP? KMP means the Chief Executive Officer or the Managing Director or the Manager, the Company Secretary, the Whole-Time Director, the Chief Financial Officer, and such other officer as may be prescribed. For the company secretaries and for the first time, we have the recognition, especially when we are in service, we have got the recognition as key managerial person. And if you are in practice, secretarial audit has become mandatory for certain class of companies and all the listed companies. So this is a great recognition for the profession of company secretaries. The use of the word "and" in the definition denotes that all these positions are to be exclusive and they are not alternative. That means a person who is a company secretary, he cannot also be the CFO of the company. There should be separate positions. Company secretary should be separate, and the chief financial officer should be separate person. Pursuant to Section 203, the appointment of KMP is compulsory to the class of companies notified by the central government. The company who doesn't fall in that such class of companies but has designated a person with that above designations, by default, they may not become a KMP unless so designated. All the listed companies and the class of companies have to have the key managerial person. And what the rule says is that the key managerial person is to be appointed by way of a board resolution at the meeting. That means this resolution cannot be passed by circulation. You have the board resolution that key managerial person is to be designated. So now the question comes, suppose when to me, but still I am appointing a chief financial officer or a company secretary, whether according to me, the answer is no. Because unless until the person has been appointed as a key managerial person, by way of a resolution of the board, he will not become a KMP by default. But there is a school of thought that they say that because the definition covers the company secretary and the chief financial officer, so by default they become KMPs, but I don't belong to that school. Now let us see what is the definition of a managing director. The managing director is the person who have to have the following characteristics. First and foremost thing is a managing director should be on the board of the company. That means he should be a director. And he must be entrusted with substantial powers of management of the company. And this entrustment of the powers may be by way of a board resolution, maybe by way of an articles of association of the company itself, or maybe by way of an agreement between the company as well as the managing director. Such powers are to be exercised subject to the superintendence and control and direction of the board. The person who occupies the position without being designated would be deemed to be a managing director. That means if you are appointing a person, a director with this kind of powers, though he has not been designated as a managing director, but he may be deemed to be a managing director and he will be dealt with accordingly suitably under the Companies Act wherever it is so required. Another KMP position is the manager. Section 2, subsection 53 defines a manager. The manager should be an individual. Earlier, good old days, we used to have the managing systems and okay, that which is no more there. So now a manager should be an individual and he must be entrusted with and in charge of the management of the whole or substantially whole of the affairs of the company. He must be subject to the superintendence and control of the guidance of the board. And a manager may be a director on the board, he may not be a director on the board. So it is not mandatory for the manager to be on the board. A person who is not designated as a manager, but who occupies the position by whatever the name you may call and exercises such kind of substantial powers over the organization, he would be regarded as a manager. That means the deeming provision is there here also. And the manager may be an employee of the company or may not be an employee of the company. So the managing director has to be necessarily on the board of the company, whereas the manager need not be on the board of the company. When a managing director, because he is an executive director, he is an employee of the company, whereas manager may be or may not be an employee of the company. Now, let me put one or two questions on this thing. Can a factory manager who has substantial powers to run the factory, whether he will be considered as a manager of the company? Say, for example, an organization is having only one factory, and there is a manager of the factory manager who got substantial powers on the fact as far as the factory is concerned. He is the king there. He can employ the people, he can sack the people there, he can fix the rules and regulations of running of the factory is concerned, how the material has to come, how the material has to go, how the material is to be produced, all the things. He got substantial powers as far as the factory is concerned. Is he a manager? Answer is no. Because a manager must be having the substantial powers overall in charge of the affairs of the company, not a particular segment of the company. Factory might be only a part of the, it may be the company might be having only one factory, but that doesn't mean he got the overall powers of that. So a factory manager can never be a manager of the company. But can a company have more than one managing director? Answer is yes, a company can have more than one managing director, and both the managing directors may be entrusted upon with substantial powers over separate affairs of the company. That means what? One managing director may be assigned with all the manufacturing operations. Another managing director may be assigned with all the market-related operations. If at all the third managing director is to be there, he may be given something else. So a company can have more than one managing director. You may call him as a joint managing director, or you may call simply set a managing director also. Can a company have a manager and managing director at the same point of time? The answer is no, because it's very clearly mentioned, because the manager himself is having the overall substantial powers of the organization. Then where is the question of having a managing director simultaneously? And at the same point of time, that section 196 also prohibits that a company cannot have a manager and managing director simultaneously. Can a company have more than one manager? Answer is yes, because Companies Act has not prohibited that a company cannot have two managers. But how can two people have overall substantial powers on the organization? So technically, it seems to be that a company cannot have more than one manager. But as far as legally it is concerned, there is no bar as such. It is also important for us to understand the difference between the manager and the managing director and the manager. Number one, the managing director should necessarily to be there to be on the board of the company, whereas manager may or may not be there on the board. A managing director is to be entrusted with substantial powers of the management, and he is not getting any powers as such by law itself, whereas manager is entrusted with wholly or substantial or the whole of the affairs of the company. Manager derives the power by virtue of the statutory position, whereas managing director is not deriving his powers. They are to be entrusted upon. He is not deriving any power by virtue of his position as such. As I mentioned, that managing director is an employee of the company, whereas manager may or may not be an employee of the company. Let us see who is the chief executive officer. This is the new position which has been recognized by Companies Act 2013. A CEO is the person who has been designated by the company as such. He is simply sitter, an officer of the company, entrusted with some powers of management. There is a difference between a managing director and a CEO. A company can have a managing director also, and a company may have a CEO also. These two positions can exist simultaneously. Accordingly, he is an officer in default and is liable to punishment under the Act. Another new concept which has been recognized by the Companies Act 2013 is Chief Financial Officer. This CFO is a person who is appointed as the CFO of the company. And if a company has to mandatorily appoint a KMP, the CFO is to be appointed by the board at its meeting. And fortunately or unfortunately, no qualifications are prescribed for a CFO, unlike a company secretary. That means a CFO need not be a chartered accountant, or a CFO need not be a cost accountant. That means even a graduate in commerce, that means a person who is a BCom or MCom or an MBA in finance, all these people can be a CFOs. Let me also say that you need not have a commerce related qualification to become a CFO of the company, but certainly it is expected that the CFO of the company should have the financial knowledge definitely. What I'm trying to say here is that though it is not required, that doesn't mean a person is always preferred to have the good qualification in finance line. Company secretary means a company secretary as defined under section 21C of the Company Secretaries Act 1980. So that means if a company has to appoint a KMP who is a company secretary, he should be a qualified secretary and he should be a member of the Institute of Company Secretaries. For the first time, the Act also has not only recognized the position of the company, of course, company secretary position was recognized under the Companies Act 1956 also, but here a company secretary has been recognized as a key managerial person, but for the first time, the Act has defined the functions and duties of a company secretary, which was not there earlier. But the Act has not defined the functions and duties of a CFO, a CEO. What are the functions of a company secretary? He has to report to the board about the compliance with the provisions of the Act. He has to ensure the company complies with the applicable secretarial standards. And he has to discharge such other duties as may be prescribed. Sweet and simple. Now, what are the duties of a company secretary? He has to provide guidance to the board of directors with regard to their duties, responsibilities, and powers. So a company secretary should be a guide and philosopher to the board. Especially, he had a crucial role to play where the company has independent directors. He is the guiding person as far as the independent directors are concerned in regard to their duties, responsibilities, and powers. At the same point of time, let me also say that this Companies Act 2013 has imposed arduous responsibilities as far as the directors are concerned. And every director may not be having knowledge as far as the Companies Act or any other law is concerned. As far as the compliance with the applicable laws is concerned, every director is responsible for that. And in the board's report, in the director's responsibility statement, they have to give an affirmation that the company has complied with all the applicable laws. So here, the company secretary has to play a very vital and crucial role in guiding the board as far as the applicable laws compliances are concerned. He is responsible to convene the board, committee, and shareholders meetings. When we say that convening the meeting is concerned, it's not that people take it very simply just to call a meeting. It is not so, you know, he has to convene the meetings within the parameters of the law. That means because tomorrow, God forbids, if any decision of the board or the shareholders or the committees come to the question, the first and foremost thing what the authorities see is that whether the meeting has been convened properly or not. So when you are convening the meeting, it is the responsibility of the company secretary to ensure the compliances as far as the Companies Act is concerned, and also the Secretary Standard 1 is concerned. To obtain approvals of the board, shareholders, and government as and when it is required, to appear before the regulators and various government authorities, to assist the board in conduct the affairs of the company, to assist and advise the board in ensuring good practices of corporate governance, and to discharge such other duties as may be specified by the board from time to time. How the KMPs are to be appointed? So as I mentioned that as per the provisions of Section 203, every company belongs to such class of companies as may be prescribed have to appoint a whole-time key managerial person. You see that though the definition is spelling out that key managerial personnel, 203 requires the appointment of a whole-time key managerial personnel. The words used that such class of companies shall have. You see that Section 203 says that the prescribed class of companies, they shall have the whole-time key managerial person, means they are not said that they shall appoint KMPs. This gives a meaning that the KMP need not be in the employment of the company. His services can be hired, his services can be seconded also. That means he need not be on the payroll of the company as such. Now, which are the class of companies they have to have a KMP? Every listed company has to have. Listed company means, let me clarify that a equity listed company or a debt listed company is a listed company, so they have to appoint a key managerial person. And every other public company having a paid up share capital of 10 crore rupees or more shall have a whole time KMP. Now, when we talk about capital, it is not only the equity capital, it is the preference capital also. So that's why if you have equity and preference together, it is more than 10 crore rupees, you have to have a KMP. Listed company, anyway, I said that it is both equity as well as debt listed company, which has its securities listed on the recognized stock exchange. That is a listed company as defined under the Companies Act. Now, Rule 8A talks about the appointment of company secretary. A company other than a company covered under Rule 8. Rule 8 talks about the rules pertaining to Section 203, whereas Rule 8A talks about the appointment of a company secretary. And it says that a company which has paid up share capital of 5 crores or more shall have a whole-time company secretary. And this has been amended recently and with effect from January 3rd, 2020. It has that earlier provision has been substituted by every private company which has a paid up share capital of 10 crore rupees or more shall have a whole time company secretary. Earlier it was a company having a paid up share capital of 5 crores or more means both your public companies and private companies, whichever are having more than 5 crore rupees paid up capital, they want to have a company secretary qualified to be appointed. Whereas now, what it was substituted means no company having the paid up capital of less than 10 crore rupees need to have a company secretary. That means a public company which is having more than 10 crores paid up capital anyway under section 203, it has to have a whole time KMP. The private companies which are having more than 10 crore rupees paid up capital under rule 8A have to appoint a qualified company secretary. He need not be a key managerial person. So, but only thing is he should be a company secretary designated. The prescribed class of companies shall appoint the following whole-time KMPs: the managing director, that means the companies which are falling under 203 under rule 8, they have to appoint these following whole-time KMPs: managing director, or CEO, or manager, and in their absence, a whole-time director. That means a company has to appoint an MD, or a company can have a CEO, or it can appoint a manager. If none of these three positions are there, then a company can have a whole-time director as a KMP, a company secretary, and a chief financial officer. So where a company has a managing director or CEO or manager, that means what? If a company is having a managing director and a whole-time director, then you have to necessarily appoint a managing director as the KMP and not the whole-time director. You can appoint both of them as KMPs, there is no issue. But leaving the managing director, you cannot appoint the whole-time director as the KMP. Same as the case with CEO and manager. Because the wording is that managing director or CEO or manager, and in their absence, a whole-time director. That means if these three positions, any of the position is there, first they have to be appointed as a KMP. Then along with them, the whole-time director may also be a KMP. Leaving them, a whole-time director cannot be appointed as a KMP as such. Of course, company secretary and CFOs are to be appointed as the KMPs wherever it is required. And such appointment has to take place, as I mentioned, that at the board meeting by way of a board resolution. Similarly, it means these three KMP positions, one person can't hold two positions. These are all exclusive whole-time positions. Means what? A person cannot hold two positions simultaneously. That means a managing director cannot be a CFO of the company also. A company secretary and CFO cannot be there. So they have to be exclusive positions. Every whole-time company shall be appointed by means of a board resolution containing the terms of appointment, including the remuneration. Another requirement is that Unlike other appointments, a whole-time KMP, when he has been appointed, his terms of appointment as well as the remuneration is to be spelled out in the board resolution itself. And similarly, as per the Rule 8 of the Companies Act, the appointment as well as the removal of the KMP shall be by way of a resolution passed at the meeting of the board. That means not only the appointment of a KMP, but also the removal of KMP is to be by way of a board resolution, and then necessary forms are to be filed along with that. A whole-time KMP of a company shall not hold office in more than one company. As I was mentioning, a managing director can be appointed as a managing director of two companies. A manager can be appointed as a manager of two companies. But a whole-time KMP of a company shall not hold office in more than one company as a whole-time KMP, except in its subsidiary company at the same time. That means if I am a KMP of a company, if I am a company secretary of XYZ Limited, and XYZ Limited has a subsidiary, maybe a whole-time subsidiary, a wholly owned subsidiary, or it may be a subsidiary simpliciter, I can be a whole-time KMP of that subsidiary, but I cannot be a whole-time KMP of another company which is not a subsidiary of the holding company. However, again, the same thing here. Some people have different interpretation. They say that in the law, sometimes you have to take the singular as plural, so that it is the what you can say is that the whole time KMP of a company can be whole time KMP of not only one subsidiary. It can be he can be whole time KMP of all subsidiaries of the company. According to me, that is also a wrong interpretation. However, a KMP can be appointed as a director of any company. As we all know that Companies Act permits a person to be appointed as a director in 20 companies, out of which it cannot be more than 10 public companies. He can be a director of whatever the company number of companies it is permitted under the Companies Act or under the listing regulations if they are listed companies. But whenever he is getting appointed as a director of any company, that he should take the permission of the board of directors of the company in which he is the KMP. A company may appoint a person as its managing director or manager of one and not more than one other company. And such appointment is to be approved by way of a board resolution at the meeting of the board. That means you cannot pass that resolution by circulation. And such resolution is to be unanimously approved by the board. That means all the directors attending the meeting should give their consent for that. And a specific notice in this regard shall be given to all the directors then in India. That means whenever you are proposing to appoint the managing director of the company for another company as a managing director or a manager, you have to mention that specifically in the agenda. And then this is to be approved by way of a resolution at the meeting. And also it should be passed unanimously. In case there is any vacancy as far as the KMP position is concerned, that vacancy should be filled by the board at the meeting, and that vacancy should be filled within a period of 6 months from the date of such vacancy. Now, with this, my presentation as far as the KMPs are concerned, it is over, and I have almost covered everything. And what we will do is we will discuss if you have any questions as far as the KMPs are concerned at the end of my presentation. Now let me switch over to dividend, a very important aspect these days. We all know that we are around the time where the annual general meetings of the companies are taking place from now to September. They're going to be, or virtually every company has to have its meeting, and most of the companies are going to declare dividends during this period. Let us understand the provisions of the dividend. First of all, what is a dividend? Dividend is a return on the investment made in the share capital of the company. That is in the simple layman's language. Dividend means a return of an investment. It is ROI. In commercial usage also, it is referred to as share of profits of the company distributed among its members. What is a dividend means? It is nothing but the share of profits of the company distributed among the members as per the discretion of the directors. That means the directors are deciding that how much of the profits have to plow back to the company and how much of the profits are to be distributed by the company. If a company is distributing the entire profits, that is also not correct. At the same point of time, if the company is very conservative and is not distributing the profits at all, then also it is not correct. However, in the initial years of the company for its growth, it requires a lot of funds, and hence it is not correct on the part of the shareholders to expect the dividends right from the year one itself. You have to give a kind of breathing time to the organizations where you have invested your money, so that first of all, they have to meet the funds requirements instead of borrowing whatever the profits generated, and only thereafter you have to go for dividends. Companies Act 2013 has for the first time defined the term dividend. Under the 56 Act, it was not defined the dividend. And in the Companies Act also, it is defined the dividend like it is an inclusive definition. It simply says that dividend includes interim dividend. That's it. What is a dividend? It has not defined, but simply it says that dividend includes interim dividend. And this is a very important definition according to me, because earlier under the 56 Act, there used to be a confusion as far as the compliances, as far as the interim dividend is concerned, what kind of compliances it has to comply with, because it is not a dividend, it is an interim dividend, which is not recognized by the Companies Act. Whereas under the new Act, this kind of confusion is no more there, because the dividend includes interim dividend. The Act has not made any distinction between interim dividend and final dividend. That's why, as far as the compliances are concerned for both the terms of dividend, that you have to ensure the same compliances. Capitalization of profits in the form of bonus shares is not dividend. As we all know that from the profits, you can issue the free reserves, you can issue the bonus shares. That is called as capitalization of the profits. And that does not amount to dividend. Hence, whenever you are issuing bonus shares, you don't need to comply with the provisions of the dividend, but you have to ensure compliance of the issue of bonus shares. Section 8 companies are prohibited from declaration of dividend by their constitution. Now let us see the definition of dividend. Now you may ask me that when the dividend is not defined, from where this definition has come. You all might be knowing that the Insular Company Secretaries has formulated four secretarial standards, that is SS1, 2, 3, 4. SS1 and 2 have got the statutory recognition under Section 118 of the Companies Act. That means SS1 and 2 pertaining to the meetings of the Board of Directors and meetings of the shareholders of the company are mandatorily you have to comply with. As far as SS3 is concerned, it is pertaining to the dividend, and SS4 is about board's report. These two standards are recommendatory, they are not mandatory, but it is advisable to comply with these two standards also, because these standards have very, after great discussions, deliberations, the Institute has formulated, and the compliances with these standards will smoothen the process as far as the disbursement of dividend is concerned, or preparation of the board's report is concerned. Friends, that we all know that as far as the board's report is concerned, such an exhaustive report it is, and so many provisions it has to comply with, which are scattered all over the Companies Act. And similarly, as far as the listing regulations are also concerned, what information has to go into the board's report, also it has scattered all over the listing regulations. So it is a kind of a route map or a navigation, this thing which has been given under the SS4 as far as the board's report is concerned. All the related provisions have been identified and put it at one place. Both these standards are also having guidance notes. So in case of any kind of clarification is required, a lot of FAQs have been also instituted in these two standards. So in the guidance notes. So any professional having any kind of issue with this dividend and board's report is concerned, you may refer to the guidance notes. So as per SS3, dividend means distribution of any sums to members out of profits and wherever permitted out of free reserves. So you may ask me that why SS3 has defined the dividend and interim dividend, why not the Act? The Act has defined, as I mentioned, that it is an inclusive definition. Whereas the purpose of the guidance, the secretary standards, is that wherever there is any kind of ambiguity, or wherever there is any scope of interpretation, or wherever there is any kind of the Act is silent about it, that point of time the standard steps in and give the kind of necessary guidance to the professionals. So in this case, what happened is, what is a dividend and what is an interim dividend? SS3 made efforts to define that. So accordingly, the dividend means distribution of any sums to the members out of profits and wherever permitted out of free reserves. And as far as interim dividend is concerned, final and interim dividend is concerned, the dividend recommended by the board and declared by the members at an AGM is final dividend. And a dividend declared by the board at the meeting of the board is an interim dividend. So SS3 said that what is a dividend? What is a final dividend and what is an interim dividend? Final dividend means it is to be recommended by the board and to be declared by the shareholders of the company. Whereas interim dividend is concerned, it is to be declared by the board. What is free reserves? Free reserves means such reserves which, as per the latest audited balance sheet of a company, are available for distribution as dividend. That means dividend can be distributed from the profits of the company or from the free reserves of the company, and dividend cannot be distributed from the capital reserves of the company. And what are the these following amounts are not part of free reserves, so you cannot declare dividend from these reserves: any amount representing unrealized gains, notional gains, or revaluation of assets, whether shown as reserves or otherwise, you cannot declare dividend. That means any unrealized gain, that means what? You have revalued your assets, say for example. By merely revaluing your assets, have you gained anything? It is nothing. Only thing is, it is a book entry only. So that's why revaluation reserves are not to be utilized for the declaration of dividend. Similarly, unrealized gain. Say, for example, the company is having some kind of investments in closely held companies. That investment, the value at cost might be different to that of the book value of the company. So is it a gain? Yes, it is a gain, but it is an unrealized gain. So from the unrealized gain, you cannot declare dividend. Any charge carrying amount to an asset or liability recognized in equally including surplus in P&L account on measurement of the asset of the liability at fair value. That means any kind of change in value of the carrying the asset or liability, that amount is also not to be used for a declaration of dividends. So once the dividend is declared, from where, what are the sources of payment for dividend? Dividend shall be paid out of the profits of the financial year for which such dividend is sought to be declared, and or out of profits of the previous financial year. That means a dividend can be declared from the profits of the financial year itself, or if the profits are not sufficient enough, what you can do is you can utilize the profits of the financial year or the also of the previous financial year. Or if you don't have any profits in this year, but you have profits, surplus profits in the P&L account of the previous financial years, so you can utilize that also. Dividend may also be declared out of the money provided by the central government or a state government if they have guaranteed to any company. That means that, okay, suppose if any outside party is joining in that company and the government has guaranteed certain portion of dividends that company will be paying, and the company has no profits and the government has given the funds, in such case that from that funds the dividend can be paid. What is the profit? Profit is not defined under the Companies Act 2013. It is nothing but surplus, that is credit balance in the profit and loss account. That means the income over the expenditure is the, you can say simply, it is the profit. In accounting terms, profit is the excess of the sales revenue, that is more or less the income, over the cost of providing the goods, services, and the expenses of the period. That means when you are taking out the cost of your raw material or your cost of your services and all the overheads relating to that, the net amount is your profit. Of course, profit is there. It is, you can say, profit before tax as well as profit after tax. Obviously, profit after tax is only available for distribution as dividend and not profit before tax. Distributable profit means the profits that are legally available for distribution as dividends, means whatever the profits which are permitted. That means in case you have any kind of capital profits, you cannot declare any dividend from the capital profits of the company. That we will see that what is the capital profit and all. The member who receives a dividend, knowing similarly, the dividend cannot be paid out of the capital of the company. What is it? How you can pay dividend out of the capital? Means that company doesn't have any profits, neither in this year nor in the previous years. The company doesn't have any free reserves, but the company has borrowed the money and paid the dividend. Means what? It is virtually company is paying dividend out of capital. That means a company which is incurring losses, which doesn't have any profits, neither in this year nor in the previous year, which doesn't have any free reserves, that company is paying virtually out of capital only. And the directors will be held responsible for that, because you cannot pay any dividend out of capital. And the member who is receiving that dividend, knowingly fully well that it is being paid out of the capital of the company, they have to make that, they are liable to make the good of the amount. Now, can you say that a member is not knowing that he is receiving the dividend out of the capital? Because it is the members who are approving the accounts. In the accounts, it is very clearly, it will be visible that the company is not having any profit, the company is not having any free reserves, but still the company is paying dividend. Means it is clearly visible from the financial statement itself, the company is paying dividend out of the capital, and the members will be held responsible to make good amount, good of that amount. While computing the profits, certain amounts are to be excluded. Any amount representing unrealized gains, notional gains, or revaluation of assets, And any changes in carrying amount of an asset or liability on measurement of the asset and liability at fair values, all these amounts are to be excluded as far as the compute while computing the profits of the company which are available for dividend. This particular thing has come in the Companies Act, Amendment Act 2017. Dividend also shall not be paid unless until the carry forward losses have been taken care of. First of all, out of the profits of the company, the carry forward losses are to be set off. That means till the previous year, I am having losses. That means your P&L account in the balance sheet is in debit. And for the first time, I have some profits in the current financial year. That doesn't mean I will pay the dividend out of the current financial year, but I have to also pay the dividend. First of all, I have to set off my carry forward losses. Before declaration of dividend, the company may consider transferring such percentage of profits to the free reserves of the company. Under the 56 Act, it was mandatory that the company has to transfer some portion of its profits to reserves accounts. That it used to be, the slabs used to be there, but according to the slabs, maximum of 10% of the profits we were to transfer to reserves, whereas now that requirement is no more there. However, if the company wants on its own, it can transfer to free reserves. Now you may ask me, what is the difference between transferring to free reserves and not transferring to free reserves? So for example, if I am having profit in this year and I am carry forwarding my profit without declaring any dividend, means what? In the balance sheet, if you see that my profit and loss account is going to show a surplus, that means that is my asset. Okay, so that as far as the P&L surplus is concerned, the board can utilize that without any kind of restrictions. It can utilize it for any purpose it wants. Say, for example, if I am declaring dividend out of the surplus in the profit and loss account, I don't need to comply with, there are no restrictions on the board, and the board need not comply any provision, simply that I can declare the dividend and I can disburse the dividend subject to the rules and regulations. Whereas, if I'm transferring a portion of the profits to the free reserves, and if I have to declare dividend out of the free reserves, then there are certain restrictions are there which I have to comply with. That's the difference between having the profit in the surplus and in the P&L account, and when you transfer it to free reserves, means it is virtually that free reserves are always for the rainy day. There are some restrictions, just like say you can say public provident fund or employee provident fund. Whenever the deduction takes place or we deposit the money in that, what will happen is for the first 15 years, they won't allow you to touch that money. Why it is? Because the public provident fund is for the rainy days and you are not supposed to withdraw the money as and when you feel like. It is not a fixed deposit. However, there is some kind of a loan is available to you from your public provident fund, whatever the balance you have. And that loan you have to repay with some kind of an interest. After 15 years, you can withdraw that. Because that was when PPF was instituted, it was instituted in such a way that for short term temptations, you should not get tempted and then withdraw the money. It is always to be there for the long term. Similarly, here also what they say was under the 56 Act, according to me, very wisely has said that whenever you have profits, the company should not distribute everything, whatever it is having it. It is not a prudent policy on the part of the board to declare whatever the profits are earned, you should not distribute it to the shareholders. You have to have the profits to plow back to meet the operational funds requirements. And at the same point of time, also to meet the rainy days. Always you have to have the reserves. That was a good part. I am surprising that I don't know why that mandatory provision has been removed under the Companies Act 2013 is concerned. When a dividend can't be declared, we have so far seen that when a dividend can be declared and when you can't declare the dividend is that in case a company is not complied with the provisions of as far as the repayment of deposits is concerned. That means a company has accepted public deposits and it has not repaid the deposits or it has not repaid the interest on that deposits till the time that kind of the failure continues. A company cannot declare dividend. That means what? Once that a company is able to repay the deposits and repay the interest, it can do it. In fact, initially when the Companies Act 2013 has legislated, it was virtually a ban. Once a company has not repaid its deposits means for the lifetime of the company, it cannot declare dividend at all. That was the provisions initially. But subsequently, the same have been amended, and rightly so also is that the moment the company is able to repay the deposits and repay the interest thereon, once that means that whatever your lapses are there, they have been rectified, then you can go ahead and pay the dividend. You can declare the dividend. This means that company can't declare dividend unless until it makes good of the default as far as the repayment of deposits is concerned. Similarly, in case a company is not able to pay the dividend, not able to repay the deposits, or it is not able to repay the interest thereon, and it is approaching the tribunal or court that it is in a position not to meet its obligations, and it has applied for some extension of time, which has been granted by the tribunal or the court, that point of time, till such the extended time, a company cannot declare dividend. That means what? On one side, you are making a default as far as the payment to your depositors are concerned, and you are making the disbursement out of the profits to your shareholders. It is not allowed. That means when a company has to declare dividends, it has to ensure that in case it accepted the deposits, that compliances as far as the repayment of deposits are concerned, that is impeccable. Similarly, a company shall not declare any dividend if it has defaulted, apart from your repayment of deposits. If it has defaulted in any of the following also, a company cannot declare dividend. What are that? Redemption of debentures. A company has floated debentures. It has not redeemed the debentures. When the debentures got matured, you have not redeemed them, or you are not paid interest on the debentures. At the same point of time, during the lifetime of the debentures, the companies have to declare debenture redemption reserve. Now some companies have been, in the recent amendments, certain companies need not create DRR, but certain companies have to create DRR. Wherever DRR is to be statutorily created, and if that DRR is not created, then you cannot pay dividend. That means wherever there is a default as far as the repayment of debentures are concerned upon its maturity, or repayment of interest is concerned, or creation of DRR is concerned during the lifetime of the debentures, then such companies cannot declare dividend. Similarly, in case of redemption of preference shares, the preference shares have been floated by the company and they have not been paid. They have been not been paid on its maturity. That means the debentures have not been redeemed, or the company has not created the CRR. As we all know that in case of the preference shares, if they are redeemed out of the profits of the company, you have to create a CRR. If you have not created the CRR, or you have not redeemed the preference shares on time, you cannot declare dividend. However, the preference shares can be redeemed out of a fresh issue of the company under such times, then you don't need to create a CRR. So that non-creation of CRR in such case is not a default at all. Payment of dividend declared in the current or previous financial year. That means you have declared dividend. Suppose you have declared interim dividend and you have not paid it. Can you declare the final dividend now? Can you the board recommend and the members declare it? Answer is no. Because you have declared interim dividend and you have not disbursed it. That itself is a lapse and a non-compliance. So you cannot declare final dividend. Similarly, you have declared dividend in the previous years. You have not disbursed that. There is a non-compliance is there. Again, the same thing. You cannot declare a fresh dividend now. Similarly, repayment of term loan to banks or financial institutions or interest thereof. You have borrowed the money by way of a term loan or by way of a working capital loan from a bank or a financial institutions, and neither you have repaid the installments nor you have repaid interest thereon. In such case also, you cannot declare dividend. However, you may approach them and you may have a kind of understanding with the banks and all if they have given you the permission. In such case, you may be able to declare the dividend. So from where the dividend cannot be declared, that means the following resources cannot be used for the purpose of declaration of dividend. Most of these are having capital in nature. That means security premium account. You cannot declare any dividend from security premium account. You cannot declare dividend from the capital redemption reserve account, revaluation reserve account, amalgamation reserve account. You cannot dividend declared out of profits or ratio of forfeited shares. And you cannot also declare dividend out of the profits earned prior to incorporation of the company. Because of the prior incorporation contracts, if any, and you are declare you gained some money out of it, these are all capital in nature, so you cannot declare dividend from any of these resources. Now, can the dividend be paid out of the reserves? The answer is yes. As we have seen that in the initial stage itself, that dividend can be declared out of the profits of the company or out of the reserves of the company. So dividend shall not be declared from the profits out of capital transactions if they are not realized in cash. That means what? You can pay dividends, though it is a capital transaction, provided it is realized in cash. That means what? Say, for example, I have capital assets. Those capital assets have lived its life. Now I am replacing them with fresh capital assets, and I'm going to dispose of these capital assets which are worn off. It is a capital transaction, and the money what I have received in the profit and loss account I am showing as gain on the sale of fixed assets or profit on sale of fixed assets. Is that money available for declaration of dividend? Answer is yes, because though it is of a capital transaction, but it is realized in cash. That's why I can pay that thing. But suppose, for example, I have simply revalued the asset. Am I getting anything in cash? Answer is no, it is merely book entry. So I cannot use the money for payment of dividend. If such profits are realized in cash, that is on sale of fixed assets, such profits may be used for declaration of dividend. This is what I have explained now. DRR would be available for distribution once the debentures are redeemed. That means what? Why? What for debenture redemption reserve we are creating every year? Out of the profits of the company, some portion you have to transfer it to debenture redemption reserve, and that money you have to invest into specified the securities or specified investments as mentioned under the act or rules thereof. And you cannot touch the money for any other purpose other than for redemption of the debentures. Now suppose you have redeemed the debentures, but still the DRR is there. That DRR may be used, you can keep it intact, provided you have some more debentures or you are going to issue fresh debentures so that you don't need to create any DRR in the future. Alternately, you have no plans to issue any more debentures, and you whatever the debentures you have issued, already you have redeemed them. Then this DRR can be transferred to general reserves, and that money can be utilized for your declaration of dividend. That means if you have created any reserve for a specific purpose, or you have created any reserve which has not realized in cash, those amounts cannot be utilized. Once the specific purpose for which the reserve is created, if that purpose is completed, then you can transfer those reserves to general reserves, and that can be utilized for the purpose of declaration of dividend. Now let us see about what is interim dividend. So far what we have declared is about dividend, and now let us see what is interim dividend. Interim dividend is a dividend declared and paid by the directors at any time between two AGMs. That means, say for example, my last AGM had taken place on September 2019 and my next AGM is going to take place on September 2020. In between, if the company, suppose the Noki wants to declare dividend, it need not wait up to the annual general meeting of the company. The board can always declare an interim dividend. However, board has to have the power under the Articles of Association of the company first to declare interim dividends. The word interim doesn't mean temporary or provisional. Interim means what? Interim means before the final dividend is declared, I am declaring the dividend in the interim period. That is what the thing is, not a temporary or a provisional dividend, something like that. Act doesn't, that means what? I am declaring a provisional dividend. Tomorrow, if it is not approved by the shareholders, you have to refund the dividend to me. It is not like that. So Act doesn't contain any provision in regard to declaration of interim dividend. As I mentioned to you that the Act has defined dividend includes interim dividend. That's why it has not created any separate provisions as far as interim dividend is concerned. And throughout the Act, you will use the word dividend only. Rarely you will have this word interim dividend. As I mentioned, the articles have to authorize the board for declaration of interim dividend. The board may declare interim dividend during the financial year. That means, for example, my financial year is 2019-20. So during this year, the interim dividend can be declared, or at any time during the period till the holding of the biannual general meeting for the financial year 1920. That means what? So for example, for the financial year 1920, my AGM is going to take place in September 2020. That means, despite the fact my financial year closed on 31st March 2020, but still from 1st April to the date of my AGM, the board can declare interim dividend pertaining to the financial year 1920. Interim dividend may be declared out of the surplus in the profit and loss account. That means the profit and loss account of 1920, it can declare, or out of the profits of the financial year for which the interim dividend is sought to be declared. That means from the previous financial year profit, I can declare it, or from the current profit of the current financial year, I can declare it. And as per the amendment, Companies Amendment Act 2017, it also said that out of the profits generated in the financial year till the quarter preceding the date of declaration of the interim dividend. That means, say, for example, in the July 2020 meeting, when I'm approving the financials for the first quarter of 2021, I can use those profits, that means the first quarter profits, to declare interim dividend for the financial year 1920 also. This is the great flexibility given to the board. But let me tell you one thing, we all have to realize that declaration and disbursement of dividend is a great responsibility as far as the board of directors are concerned. They have to be very careful just to give a boost to the price of the share of you in the market. The dividend is not to be declared. It is the board, especially whenever it is declaring interim dividend, the board has to be taken a great responsibility. I will discuss that further in my future slides. This means that board can declare interim dividend even after the closure of the financial year and also from the profits of next financial year. That means so far what we have discussed was a company can declare dividend from the current profits or from the profits of the previous financial years. Now, post Companies Amendment Act 2017, I can also utilize the profits of my previous quarter in the current financial year to pay dividend for the previous financial year. What are the restrictions? While declaring interim dividend, the board should satisfy itself that the financial position of the company justifies and supports such declaration. As I was mentioning that the board has to ensure that the financial position of the company is strong enough to declare and disburse the interim dividend. Board, can it declare only once in a financial year, or can the board declare more than once interim dividend in a financial year? The board can declare as many interim dividends as it wants from the in a financial year. If you see that TCS is a company which declares not less than minimum of 2 to 3 dividends in a year, and sometimes it may also come with a special dividend also. And most of the companies, there are some good dividend paying companies are there. In case the company incurs loss during the current financial year up to the end of the quarter immediately preceding the date of declaration of interim dividend, then there is a restriction on as far as the percentage of the dividend is concerned. Such interim dividend shall not be declared at a rate higher than the average dividends of the previous 3 financial years. That means if I am declaring interim dividend, say in the financial year October to December, that means in the October board meeting, I want to declare, I'm declaring a dividend while considering the October results, and the July-September quarter, there is a loss, though there was a profit in April-June quarter, but still, whether I am declaring an interim dividend out of the profits of April to June quarter or from the previous financial year, there is a restriction as far as the rate of dividend is concerned, and that rate is the average rate of dividend declared during the previous 3 financial years. The financial results shall take into account the depreciation for the full year. That means if any, whenever you are the depreciation, whatever is not been created, the full depreciation is to be set off first of all. Similarly, the tax on profits of the company, including deferred tax for full year, is to be taken into account. That means the board has to take all these precautions while declaring interim dividend. Depreciation for the full year is to be taken into account. Tax on profits is to be taken into account. In case you are anticipating any losses in the financial year, suppose, for example, I am declaring a dividend in the month of September. I need to ensure all these for the full financial year. Are you anticipating any losses in the previous, in the that remaining period of the financial year? Dividend that would be paid at the fixed rate on preference shares. If you have issued any preference shares, you have to declare dividend on that. So you need to make a provision for the dividend on the preference shares also. In case equity shares were issued with differential rights as to dividend, interim dividend may be declared on all or any one or more class of such shares. Because that means what? Whenever you are issued shares with differential voting rights, if in that differential voting rights, that those certain shares have no dividend rights, but they have only voting rights, obviously you will not consider those shares for dividend at all. Suppose those shares are having voting dividend rights, but not the voting rights, obviously you have to consider them for the purpose of dividend. In case interim dividend is declared on only one class of shares, the board shall ensure that the profit shall be adequate to meet the dividend that would be paid on other class of shares. This is as I given a standard example of preference shares. Suppose when that you have issued preference shares, say 9% preference shares, mean the dividend rate is already decided at the time of issue itself that you have to pay 9% preference dividend on the preference shares. And when the board is considering the interim dividend, that point of time, not necessarily the board has to first pay the dividend on preference shares and then you have to declare interim dividend. It is not so. Board can declare interim dividend. That dividend can be disbursed to equity shareholders, but you have to ensure that at the end of the year, you should be in a position to pay the dividend on the preference shares. Where equity shares were issued with differential rights as to voting only, no differentiation shall be made on the declaration of interim dividend. This is what I have mentioned. That means you have differential rights shares. That means those shares are having, they don't have voting rights, but they have dividend rights. Means virtually all the shares are more or less alike and you have to declare interim dividend on all the shares of the company. Interim dividend can be declared by the directors between two AGMs provided the articles of the company so authorizes. This is what I have mentioned. Act provides that unless final dividend, interim dividend must be approved or confirmed or ratified by the members in general meeting. This is also the same thing. There are two schools of thoughts are there here. One school of thought says that the interim dividend is to be ratified by the shareholders. Some say it is to be confirmed by the shareholders at the AGM. Some people say it is to be approved by the shareholders at the AGM. Whereas Act nowhere says that. Act simply says that the board can declare interim dividend provided its articles authorize. That means what? Board has this power very clearly. And this, according to me, the interim dividend need not neither be to be ratified by the AGM, by the members at the AGM, nor to be approved, nor to be noted. But however, some companies, by abundant caution, they get it noted by the members. That means no more dividend is there. Only whatever the interim dividend is there, that itself is the final dividend. But the moment you say that it is to be ratified by the shareholders, it is to be approved by the shareholders, my question to that is tomorrow, if that the dividend is not ratified or approved, are you going to take back that dividend from the shareholders? It is not so. So a declaration of dividend by a company in general meeting is a debt. That means the moment a company declares a dividend in the general meeting, it is a debt. So under the Companies Act 2013, dividend includes interim dividend. So according to me, even interim dividend, once it is declared by the board, it is a debt and it is to be paid to the shareholders of the company. Now, let us see that I don't have profits, or I have profits, but they are not sufficient for the amount of dividend what I want to declare. Can I pay the dividend out of my free reserves? Answer is yes. because the reserves which are available for distribution of dividend are called as free reserves. So I can pay, I can declare dividend out of my free reserves. It may be interim dividend, it may be final dividend. However, there are certain restrictions out there when I'm declaring dividend out of the free reserves. In a year in which profits are inadequate or there were no profits, the dividend can be declared out of free reserves subject to the fulfillment of the following conditions. What is that? The rate of dividend shall not exceed the average of the rates at which dividend was declared in the three financial years immediately preceding. That means if I am declaring any dividend out of the rate of dividend, there is a restriction on the rate of dividend. What is that? That means, say, for example, in the previous three financial, in the second year, 10% in the third year. Of the three financial years is 7%. So hence, the rate of dividend, what I'm going to declare now, whether it is interim or final, it cannot be more than 7%, the average of previous three financial years. In case there is no dividend was declared in each of the three preceding financial years, this seems to be not up, this will not be applicable. Some people got a confusion that, say, for example, out of the three financial years, I have declared dividend only for two financial years. That means first financial year, I have not declared anything. I have started declaring dividend only from the last two financial years. Now in this financial year, I am paying the dividend out of the free reserves. When I'm averaging it, that is to be averaged by two or by three. Whether you declared dividend or not, average of three financial years means you have to take it that 2 years, whatever the rate you have declared, and the third year you have to take it zero, add all the three, divide by three, then that is coming to this. Three financial years average means it is divisible by three, not by two. Again, the same thing here also, some people have the different methods, but this is the correct method according to me. Now, declaration of dividend out of free reserves, total withdrawal from the accumulated profits shall not exceed 1/10 of the paid up share capital and free reserves of the company. That means what? You can utilize the free reserve. That doesn't mean you dig whatever it is there. That means entire money I want to pay for dividend. No, it will not be permitted. There is a restriction. First restriction was on the rate of dividend. Second restriction is the amount what you are withdrawing from the free reserves. What is that restriction? It should not exceed 10% of the 1/10 of the paid up capital, paid up share capital. That means your equity plus preference and free reserves of the company. For example, if the paid up capital of the company is 10 crores and the free reserves of the company is say 90 crores, total is 100 crores. So the withdrawal amount can be permitted is 1/10 of it. That means you can withdraw 10 crore rupees and you can declare dividend for 10 crore rupees. That is the maximum amount you can pay, not beyond that. That means even though your rate of dividend may be slightly higher based on the 3 years average dividend, you can declare a higher rate of dividend, but the maximum amount available to you is only 10 crores. So maybe your rate you have to slash again. So these restrictions are exclusive, they are not inclusive. The amount so withdrawn shall be first utilized to set off the losses. This is another restriction. That means the 10 crores what I am withdrawing, it is not like that I am going to pay off anything. In case you have incurred any losses in the current financial year, first of all, you have to set off those losses from this 10 crores. So for example, I have incurred a loss of 5 crores during the financial year. So the 10 crores what I have withdrawn from the free reserves, first of all, I have to set off this 5 crores losses during this current financial year, and the amount available with me for disburse for the distribution of dividend is only 5 crores. So my dividend rate of dividend will be accordingly, it will be further slashed. The balance reserves after such a withdrawal shall not follow below 15% of the paid up share capital. This is another restriction. The balance reserves after such withdrawal, the first restriction was rate of dividend. Second restriction was the amount what I can withdraw. Third restriction was I have to set off the losses. And the fourth restriction is the balance of the free reserves after such withdrawal shall not follow below 15% of my paid up share capital. That means, for example, the available reserves are say 23 crores. and the paid up capital of the company is say 50 crores. So my reserves after some withdrawal should not fall below 15% of my paid up share capital. My paid up share capital is 50 crores. 15% of that comes to 7.5 crores. Hence, after the withdrawal of the amount of reserves shall not fall below 15.5 crores. Okay. The above conditions shall not be applicable to a government company. In the event of a loss, interim dividend shall not be declared out of free reserves. Now, this is an important thing. What you have to remember is that dividend can be declared out of free reserves, but interim dividend cannot be declared out of free reserves. However, interim dividend can be declared from the surplus in the profit and loss account. This is what I explained in the very beginning, if you remember. The advantage to the board, in case the amount is available in the surplus in the profit and loss account, the board can utilize that money the way it wants. But the moment you transfer it, you have to comply with all these restrictions. However, final dividend can be declared from the free reserves subject to the above conditions. If dividend declared out of the profits of the previous years, that will not tantamount to declaration of dividend out of the free reserves. This also has. Now let us say declaration of dividend. Declaration of dividend is a part of ordinary business. There are, as you might be knowing, ordinary business is such business which is to be transacted only at the annual general meeting of the company. That ordinary business is four items normally: approval of financial statements, declaration of dividend, appointment of directors retiring by rotation, and in case appointment of auditors is there, that is also that. So these four businesses are part of ordinary business, and ordinary business can be transacted only at the general meeting. That means dividend shall not be declared at an AGM or by way of postal ballot. Dividend is to be declared only at the AGM, and interim dividend can be declared by the board. Suppose your articles doesn't permit the declaration of interim dividend by the board, that means only dividend can be declared at the annual general meeting of the company. And similarly, that though there is no restriction as such under the Companies Act that the dividend is to be declared only at the meeting of the board of directors, that means technically dividend can be declared by passing a resolution by circulation. However, as per SS3, the dividend is to be recommended only at the meeting of the board of directors, because as I have mentioned that whenever this declaration of dividend is a very great responsibility on the directors, they have to consider financials before declaration of dividend. In fact, some people ask me a question that whenever the board is declaring interim dividend, whether the financial statements are to be prepared. My answer to that is if you are not preparing the financial statements, how you will come to know you have profits or losses? Similarly, that if you are not preparing this financials, how you will ensure that you have set off the carry forward losses, you have set off the losses incurred in the financial year. Similarly, whether you have kept a reserve for the dividend to be declared on preference shares. So nowhere these things have written that, you know, before declaration of interim dividend, you have to necessarily have financials, whether the financials are to be audited or not. Again, as per the Act, nowhere it is mandatory for the accounts are to be audited. If your accounts are audited, what you will get, the board will get a great comfort that the auditor has taken care of the way the accounts have been prepared. So especially if you are an independent director in any company and the company is declaring interim dividend, you should insist for the financials are to be prepared and is also to be audited by the auditor of the company. Board shall consider annual financial statements duly recommended by the audit committee. If you have an audit committee, that board has to consider the financial statements recommended by the audit committee for declaration of dividend. Dividend shall not be recommended subject to any conditions. Dividend should never be, it should be a simpliciter dividend declaration. You cannot say the dividend will be declared subject to the approval by the financial institutions or subject to the approval of the NCLT or something like that. That means you cannot declare dividend a conditional dividend. Then members, while declaring the dividend recommended by the board, may declare a lower rate, but they may not increase it. That means what? When the dividend, final dividend is to be declared, it is to be recommended always by the board. Only interim dividend board can declare, final dividend board cannot declare, it can only recommend to the, suppose for example, your articles have not permitted the board to declare interim dividend. So what the board can do at the most, it can only recommend the dividend to the shareholders of the company, and the shareholders can declare such dividend at the annual general meeting of the company. Only whatever is recommended, they can take, suppose for example, if the board has recommended 10% on the per share, 10% of the face value of the share, the shareholders can reduce it to 8% or 5% or 6%, but they cannot increase to 12%. And dividend shall be disclosed on per share basis, though it is applicable to all listed companies as per the listing regulations. But SS3 also recommends that the dividend is to be always declared on per share basis, because the face value is different. It is 1 rupee share is there, 2 rupee share is there, 5 rupee share is there, 10 rupee share is there. If you say simply for that, you know, that percentage, then you will not come to know. So it is, you have to always declare per share basis. No dividend shall be declared for previous financial years on equity shares in respect of which the financial statements are already adopted. That means if the financial accounts are adopted, then you cannot declare interim dividend in respect of that particular year, or you cannot declare any dividend in respect of that particular year. Arrears of dividend on cumulative preference shares may, however, to be declared and paid. In case you have that, as we all know that the preference shares may be cumulative or non-cumulative. If it is a cumulative preference share, the dividend gets accumulated year after year, and ultimately the arrears are to be paid. And let me also tell you that sometimes it may so happen, the preference shares are to be redeemed as per the tenure of that thing. Say, for example, if it is a 10-year preference shares, in the 10 years, the preference shares might have been redeemed, but they could not pay the dividend. The dividend accumulation is still there. But before that company declares any dividend, first and foremost, the arrears on the preference shares are to be paid off. Similarly, in case of non-cumulative preference shares, if the company is not in a position to declare any dividend in respect of a financial year, that preference shareholders cannot get any dividend in the future years. Distribution of discount coupons, it shall not be amount to deemed dividend. A company is prohibited to issue bonus shares in lieu of dividend. Interim dividend shall be declared by the board, and members' approval is not required. This I have already explained. It shall be declared by the board at a meeting only. This also I explained. It shall not be declared out of the interim dividend, cannot be declared out of the free reserves. In case the company has issued preference shares, the board should ensure sufficient profits are there to pay off. Interim dividend once declared by the board, its approval, noting ratification, is not required. Interim dividend is very much a debt. In the board's report, the details of interim dividend should be mentioned. The listed companies, as per the listing regulations, the top 500 listed companies have to formulate a dividend distribution policy. And this policy is also to be part of the annual report. And the recommendation or declaration of any dividend by these companies shall be in line with the dividend distribution policy of the company. What are the parameters of this policy is the circumstances under which the shareholders may or may not expect dividend. The financial parameters that shall be considered while declaring the dividend. And please note that dividend means including interim dividend. Internal and external factors that shall be considered for declaration of dividend. Policy as to how the retained earnings shall be utilized, and parameters that shall be adopted with regard to various classes of shares. Now, so far what we have done is that we have examined that what is dividend, what is interim dividend, what are the sources of dividend, and similarly before declaring the dividend from the sources, when I am digging out my previous resources, then what the restrictions are there, all these things we have discussed. Now the question comes to who are entitled for dividend. Dividend shall be paid only to the registered holders of the company, or to their order, or to their bankers. That means I can pay the dividend to the register holder, or even if it is the shares are held in the electronic mode, obviously the beneficiaries as per the download of the BenPOS, I can do it. Or suppose if I am ordering that the dividend is to be paid to XYZ, the company is under obligation to pay the dividend to that XYZ. Dividend shall be paid to those members whose name appears in the BenPOS in case of electronic holding. This I already explained to you. And if the shareholders are holding the shares in physical mode, as per the register of members of the company, that is considered as ROM. Effect to be given to all valid share transfers lodged before the record date and the book date. As we all know that whenever you have declared dividend, you have to close your books, or you have to have a record date, you have to declare. And as on that record date, whose names appear in the register of members or as per the download, the BenPOS download from depositories, those are the people who are entitled for dividend. In case of a listed company, from that day onwards, the X dividend will be, the price will be adjusted accordingly. Now, preference shareholders will be paid dividend before dividend is paid to the equity shareholders. As I told you, in case of interim dividend, this is not applicable. Interim dividend can be paid before the dividend is paid to the preference shareholders, but the board has to ensure sufficient sum is available to pay to the preference shareholders at the end of the financial year. Preference shares carried a preferential right over the equity shares as far as the dividend is concerned. This right is subject to availability of distributable profits. As I told you, if there are no profits, the preference shareholders cannot compel the company to declare dividend, because payment declaration of dividend out of capital is prohibited. At the same point of time, if it is a cumulative preference share, the dividend get accumulated. If it is a non-cumulative preference shares, the dividend will not be available. This preferential statement, as if the preferential treatment, is as and when the dividend is declared to equity shareholders. Dividend on preference shares can also be paid out of free reserves, subject to its declaration. In case where dividend is declared from free reserves, preference shareholders have priority over equity shareholders. Since the rate of dividend on the preference shares is already fixed, the board may declare such dividend in the preference shares. Some companies, they don't go to the shareholders for declaration of dividend on the preference shares, but it is not a correct methodology. Always advisable that it is also to be declared by the shareholders as far as the dividend on preference shares also is concerned, though it is that the rate was decided earlier. Before declaring interim dividend, though preference shareholders need not be paid, as this I already told you, availability of amount is to be ensured. In case there are two or more class of preference shares, the holders of the class which has priority are entitled to their preference dividend over the other class. They are to be paid first and others are to be paid last. This is as per the terms of preference shareholders. Areas of cumulative preference shares, if it is a cumulative, it has to be paid. Non-cumulative need not be paid. There may be some participating preference shares. This is a new class of shares. In this case, what will happen is the preference shares holders will get the dividend, whatever is agreed at the time of issue of the preference shares. Subsequently, what they will do is over and above X percentage of dividend to the equity shareholders, they will also be able to participate. I will give an example to you. Say it is 10% participating preference shares. That means the preference shareholders are entitled for a dividend of 10%, come what may, provided the profits are there. And in case the dividend to the equity shareholders, suppose at the time of issuing of the participatory preference shares, it is mentioned that any time the dividend to the equity shareholders over and above 10%, on the excess amount, the preference shareholders will also get equal proportion. That means what? If the dividend is declared at 12%, that means the 2% amount, the participating preference shares holders will also be entitled. Where shares are with differential voting rights, then accordingly you have to give it. Sometimes it may so happen that the differential right owners will have dividend but not voting rights, then they have to pay dividend. Sometimes they may have voting right, they have dividend right, but not, voting right, but not dividend, then you won't pay any kind of dividend to them. In case of preference shareholders, cumulative preference share, despite the fact they are redeemed, still you have to pay the arrears. and participating, non-participating, we already discussed. In addition to entitled to participant, the surplus profit is also mentioned. Now let us see the dividend in abeyance. Once you declare dividend in certain circumstances, you have to keep the dividend in abeyance. In case of shares which have not been transferred as the ownership is in dispute, suppose the who is entitled then? Okay, suppose I say that I have purchased the shares from Mr. X, and Mr. X says, no, I have not sold it. It is only a bogus transfer deed. So there is a dispute. Now both the parties have gone to the court and it is pending. The proceedings are pending. The point of time, if the company is have been given a notice about that, the those dividends is to be kept in abeyance. Where there are specific prohibitory orders are there by the court or any statutory authority, the dividend should be kept in abeyance and the transfer to unpaid dividend account as and when it becomes due. Now let us see the payment of dividend. Dividend is shall be deposited within 5 days of declaration to a separate bank account, and the intervening holidays falling during such 5 days are also to be included. That means, suppose for example, if the dividend is declared on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, by Tuesday you have to deposit the amount. Sunday and Saturday will also be counted for this purpose. Any amount which remains unpaid or unclaimed after the period of 30 days, that means dividend is to be disbursed within a period of 30 days. Though it is to be transferred to a separate account in 5 days, it is to be disbursed in a period of 30 days. If it is not disbursed or if the dividend is not unclaimed within 30 days, then that whatever the amount is there, that is to be transferred to a separate account, unpaid dividend account. The amount deposited in the bank shall be utilized for payment of dividend. Whatever the amount is left out after 7 years, that same is to be transferred to IEPF account. And for no purpose, that amount is to be utilized. Deposit in bank account within 5 days shall not be applicable to government companies. Taxes on distribution of dividends shall be paid as per the tax provisions. As we all know that till last year, that means last financial year, which was closed by 31st March 2020, there was a dividend distribution tax which the corporates were to pay, and the dividend was tax-free in the hands of the recipient. But from 1st April 2020 onwards, there is dividend distribution tax. That means the corporates are not paying any tax. The tax, it is taxable in the hands of the recipient. Then whatever the provisions are, legal provisions are there, up to 5,000 rupees, no tax need to be deducted as far as the companies are concerned. Otherwise, over and above 5,000 rupees dividend, the companies have to necessarily deduct the tax at source. Dividend shall be paid in cash and not in kind. Dividend shall be paid through electronic mode and which shall not be possible through physical warrant, where it is impossible through physical warrant. That means, if wherever the ECS mandate, electronic credit mandates are received by the company, the dividend can be declared, disbursed by crediting to the respective bank accounts of the shareholders. The people who are not registered their ECS mandates, you have to pay the dividend by way of a physical warrant or by way of a check, which is to be physically dispatched. As per the circular 20, now, wherever the ECS mandates are not registered with the companies, the company on declaration of dividend, you don't need to send any physical warrants to the shareholders, because under the lockdown situation, you are not in a position to do that. So it doesn't amount to a non-compliance. The physical warrants will be dispatched to the shareholders on and as and when the normalcy is restored. Calls in arrears and any other sum due from a member in relation to shares may be adjusted against the dividend. In case of unlisted companies, if the articles so provide, it is not only the call money, you can adjust any money which is due to the company from the concerned person against the dividend, provided the articles permit. Calls in arrears may be adjusted against the dividend payable to any member. This power may be exercised irrespective of whether that articles of the company provides or not. As far as the adjustment of calls in arrears is concerned, article need not give the authority to the company. Adjustment of any other amount is possible only in case of unlisted companies, because listed companies, it cannot do that. LODR doesn't permit it. So a listed company may adjust the amount of dividend against the calls in arrears or any other sums from a member in the capacity of a member. In case other companies, any other sums due from member in any other capacity may also be adjusted if the articles so provide. Dividend shall be paid through electronic mode. This means that this is as far as the listed companies are concerned, dividend is to be paid in electronic mode. If the ECS mandate is not registered or certain areas where that electronic cash credit is not possible, that point of time you have to send the dividend warrants. And as per the listing regulations, any dividend which is over 1,500 rupees, you have to send those warrants by way of a registered post or speed post. Now let us see the unpaid dividend. Once declared dividend, it is to be distributed within 30 days. Within 5 days, the dividend amount is to be put into a separate bank account. I was just saying how much time. Yeah, we have time. So within 5 days of the dividend amount shall be transferred to a separate bank account, and such amount shall be utilized only for payment of dividend to transfer to unpaid dividend or IEPF account. And within 30 days, if the dividend is not disbursed or if the amount is unpaid or unclaimed, that is to be transferred to unpaid dividend account. And such transfer shall be made within 7 days from the date of expiry of the 30-day period. Within a period of 90 days, of the transferring the amount to unpaid dividend account, a statement containing the names, addresses, and amounts of dividend unpaid shall be uploaded in the form IEPF 2 in the website of the company. That means the companies which have declared dividend, and within 90 days of that, those companies have to upload the unpaid account details. That means shareholder-wise, folio-wise, how much is the amount, it is there on the website of the company, as well as on the website of the central government specified, the IEPF website. Now let us see the IEPF, Investor Education Protection Fund. This fund is established by central government. And what are the amounts to be credited to this fund is any grants, donations from central government. That means if the fund has received any grants and donations, dividend unclaimed, unpaid for a period of consecutive 7 years, amount lying in IEPF established under the old act, it is to be transferred here. Amount received through disgorgement or disposal of securities in connection with personification for acquisition of the securities under Section 38, that is also to be credited to IEPF. Once the amount is due for transfer to IEPF, the same should be transferred within 30 days to the IEPF authority. The company should furnish, once the amount is transferred, the challan copy as well as IEPF 1 form is to be filed with the authorities. Within 90 days, as I told you, in the details of unpaid dividend are to be uploaded on the website of the company in form IEPF 2. Where the dividend was unpaid or unclaimed for a consecutive period of 7 years, apart from the dividend, the corresponding shares are also to be transferred to the authorities DMAT account. That means under the new act, it is also provided that even the shares are also to be transferred to the DMAT account. That means when they said that consecutive period of 7 years means during the 7 year period, even if one dividend is encashed, then you don't need to transfer the shares to that particular account because the word used is consecutive period of 7 years. In case of the 7 year period is completed or being completed during the period, for the first time it has been started is in 2017, this was notified. Initially, there was a small hiccup as far as the DMAT account of the ministry is concerned. That's why what they said was any amount which is to be transferred between September 17 to October 31st, 2017, that due date will be deemed to be 31st October 2017. This is purely on account of some technical glitches as far as the IEPF DMAT account is concerned. 3 months before the due date to transfer, the company should inform the shareholders at their last known address. There is a procedure is there before you transfer the amount as well as the securities are concerned. What you have to do is a 3 months notice is to be given to the shareholders as per the last known address, as per the ROIM or as per the BENPOS of the company. And that notice is to be published that the company is being transferred the shares of these people who have not encashed their dividend warrant for the last 7 years. And In case of the following cases, the dividend shall not be transferred to IAPF authority. There is a specific court order or a tribunal order or from a statutory authority, means any income tax or anybody else. Such shares were pledged or hypothecated under the provisions of the Depositories Act, then also not to be transferred to IAPF. In such cases, the company shall furnish such details of the IAPF 3 within 30 days from the end of the financial year. That meant wherever they are not transferring any shares, despite the fact that dividend was not encashed for the consecutive 7 financial years, because of these reasons, they are not transferring the shares, and they have to furnish the details in IAPF 3 form. Once the shares, as well as the corresponding to unpaid or unclaimed dividend for 7 consecutive years, is transferred, the company shall send a statement in IAPF 4. The company shall maintain the details of such transfers. The voting rights on such shares is frozen. This is also a very good thing. It has been very clearly given that the voting rights on the shares transferred to IAPF account are frozen. The shares which have been transferred to IAPF authority shall not be excluded. Whenever you are calculating the voting rights, you should not do it. Otherwise, there will be a big problem as far as the takeover regulations is concerned, as far as the promoter's holding is concerned. All corporate benefits such as bonus shares, split, consolidation, fraction, etc. shall be credited to the DMAT account of IAPF authority. That means only right shares, nobody will apply as far as these shares are concerned, because rights, obviously, IAPF is not going to apply for these people. But suppose you have declared any bonus shares, and the corresponding bonus shares of the shares what you already transferred to IAPF, they are also to be transferred to IAPF. If you have split the shares or you have consolidated the shares, all these are to be transferred to the IAPF account. Because please note that unlike earlier act, whatever the dividend amount unpaid you have transferred to IAPF account, as well as the shares are concerned, they can be claimed back by the shareholders. Not only the dividend what you have transferred after 2013, but also the dividend what you have transferred under the old act also. Though under the old act you could not have withdrawn the money, now you can withdraw that. Shares in the DMAT account of IAPF authority shall be used only to transfer back to the claimant. That means whatever the shares which are lying in the IAPF account, those shares are to be utilized only for the purpose of to return to the claimant, but not for any other purpose. In case the company is getting the shares delisted, the authority shall surrender those shares and the proceeds realized shall be credited to the fund. Now let us see the business provisions pertaining to the dividend. Once declared, a dividend becomes a debt and shall not be revoked. Dividend warrants and registers shall be preserved for a period of 8 financial years. Thereafter, the same may be destroyed with the approval of the board or as per the policy of the company as far as the records are concerned. No document preservation policy. In fact, if it is a listed company, as per the regulation 9 of LODR, the company, they have to have a policy of document preservation policy. Then as per that, you can destroy those records. Notes and accounts forming part of financial statements shall disclose the aggregated amount of dividend proposed on equity shares and preference shares. Arrears of preference shares shall be disclosed separately. Under the head current liabilities and provisions, the amount lying in unpaid dividend account together with interest accrued thereon shall be disclosed. Interim and final dividends shall also be disclosed under the board's report. You have to specify that what was the interim dividend, what was the final dividend. And as I have mentioned that not only the percentage, even the actual dividend is to be mentioned as per share basis. Annual report shall disclose the total amount lying in the unpaid dividend account in respect of the last 7 years and such unpaid dividend due for transfer. Amount transferred to IAPF account shall also be disclosed in the board's report, not only of that year, but also cumulatively. It is the responsibility of the board, and as a good governance point of view also, as statutory point of view also, and shareholder-friendly point of view also, to remind the shareholders and to take all efforts to identify the shareholders to get their dividend encashed. Because once you transfer the dividend amount or the shares or the corresponding shares to the a EPF account. If not impossible, it is not that simple to get the shares or the amount back. That's why it is the responsibility of the company directors. Means what? It is the responsibility of the company secretary to take all proactive steps to inform the shareholders from time to time. Especially, you have to also see that, you know, okay, that the slabs of unpaid dividend, if the amount is very high, you should be able to make efforts to approach those shareholders. Especially in case of Reliance Industries, we do that. Every year, whenever any correspondence goes to our shareholders, we also do intimate that if any unpaid dividend is there, we tell them that to claim that particular dividend. And whatever the precautions we have to take, we do take that. Apart from the statutory things, as a shareholder-friendly company, the companies, as well as the company secretary's responsibility is to update and apprise the shareholders to encash their dividends. Because several times it may so happen that shareholders might be thinking, the amount is so small, why I have to go and deposit my, see, especially in case of physical warrants, what happened is people are a bit lazy to go to get it deposited in the bank account, considering the amount is very small. But please note that if the dividend is not encashed, now the corresponding shares also are to be transferred to IEPF account. So one has to be very careful. Finally, the penal provisions are also very, very stringent as far as the dividend related provisions are concerned. Once a dividend is declared and is not paid as per the provisions of the Act, every director of the company shall, if he is knowingly a party to the default, be punishable with imprisonment, which may extend to 2 years. And with fine, which shall not be less than 1,000 rupees for every date during which the default continues. Less than 1,000 rupees for every day it is during which the default continues. The company shall be liable to pay simple interest at the rate of 18% per annum during the period for which such default continues. There are one or two small spell mistakes out there, and my apologies for that. That means what? This is a non-compoundable offense. So the imprisonment is there and the penal provisions are there. That means that the monetary penalty is there. So this is a non-compoundable offense. So the directors have to be very, very clear on this thing, and especially the independent director should be very careful. Only the saving and disgrace is that if he is knowingly a party to the default, that means as and when the directors come to know that the company is defaulting in payment of dividend, they have to bring to the notice of the board, notice of the chairman, they have to put on record that it is to be paid, they have to take necessary efforts, the company is making the good of the default, and still if it is not being done, they may have to step down from the company in this thing. Because tomorrow definitely they will be held responsible for non-payment of dividend, and one should be very careful as far as this is concerned. No offense will be committed in the following cases. That means though the dividend is not paid, it will not amount to a default. Where dividend could not be paid by any operation of law, directions given by the shareholders could not be complained with the same intimated to him. That means suppose somebody has given an ECS mandate, but that ECS particulars are not correct, you are not able to pay it. In case of dispute in regard to the right to receive dividend, that means dividend is kept in abeyance unless until the dispute is resolved. Dividend was lawfully adjusted by the company, that means it was adjusted against the cost areas or against any money due to the company as per the articles where it provides in case of unlisted companies. Failure to pay dividend or to post the warrant was not due to the any default on the part of the company. That means what? That any force majeure reasons are there. The point of time the dividend could not be disbursed, then the company will not be held responsible for that. Additional compliances for listed companies. The equity shares allotted to companies shall rank pari passu with the existing shares, shall not issue shares in any manner which may confer superior rights as to the voting of or dividend in equity shares. They are already listed. Now only some superior rights shares can be issued as per the listing regulations. Prior intimation to stock exchanges about the board meeting, 2 working days in advance. Intimate of the record date, 7 days in advance. Intimation of record date, at least 5 working days before the record date is fixed. Company shall disclose the outcome of the board meeting to the stock exchanges within 30 minutes of the meeting. Shall also intimate the date on which such dividend shall be paid or dividend warrant shall be dispatched. Dividend shall be declared, disclosed per share basis only. Top 500 companies shall have a dividend distribution policy, and the same shall be disclosed in the annual reports of the company to be uploaded on their websites. This I have already mentioned, parameters of dividend distribution policy. Thank you very much for your patient listening. And now I am ready to take any questions you have.
Sir, would you please explain methods for calculation of depreciation?
Yeah, what is that, madam? Come back again. Hello?
Sir, methods for calculation of depreciation.
See, calculation of depreciation is as per your schedule 5. Schedule 6, I think, if I'm not. Under the old schedule 13, we used to have it. Different assets, you have different depreciation rates. If you are applying straight line method or if you are applying WDV method. So you have to, the depreciation is not a uniform depreciation rate. A different depreciation is there. Only thing what you have to ensure is that before you are declaring dividend, the depreciation is to be set off first and then only the available profits you have to take care of. For example, if I'm having 100 rupees profit is there, but the current year depreciation is 10 rupees and the previous year depreciation I could not set off from my profit and loss account, that is 50 rupees. So total is 60, 100 minus 60, so only 40 rupees is available for me for distribution of dividend. So it is to be calculated.
Can company secretary be held liable for any wrong information, financial statements?
See, company secretary is a whole-time KMP, and similarly, company secretary, whether he is a whole-time KMP or not, he is an officer in default. Apparently, he will be held responsible as far as the dividend, the non-compliance of dividend distribution provisions are there or disbursement is there. However, company secretary also can always safeguard himself because he is not the person physical who has the authority to dividend to disburse the dividend. But tomorrow, if he is held liable, he should be able to defend himself that he brought it to the notice of the board from time to time and he is not at default as far as it is concerned. Similarly, independent directors are concerned, the same thing is there for them also. In fact, I will say that there is one, I'm forgetting the name of the case, I think. It is a former IT company where the dividend was declared but was not paid. Then the audit committee chairman came to know about the non-disbursement of dividend. Audit committee has summoned the CEO as well as CFO of the company, and they have assured the audit committee that the dividend will be disbursed. Within 15 days, the dividend was not disbursed. The audit committee chairman again called the meeting, ensured that everything is recorded in the minute, and he also called for a meeting of the board. At the board meeting, he informed the chairman that the company has lapsed in as far as the disbursement is concerned. Ensured that also is recorded. And SEBI has issued the notices to all the directors of the company. The independent directors, what they did, despite the fact they brought it to the notice of the chairman that they have not paid, so they resigned from the company. After their resignation, they have received showcase notices from the SEBI. They could establish that they have taken necessary precautions by producing the committee minutes as well as the board minutes, which is clearly spelling out that the independent directors have taken all remedial measures, whatever they were supposed to take. So they were not a party to that. They have been absolved from their responsibility.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your insightful discussion. We have got some queries. I will just request you to please address those queries as well. We have taken all the queries from YouTube link as well as the other posted on this WebEx platform also. So I will just share one Word file on this link itself so that you can simultaneously view also.
Otherwise, you can read Amit.
Yes, sir. I will. Can you see it now, sir?
No, not able to. Yes.
The first query is that she is perhaps asking that in form DIR 12, while we are filling the form DIR 12 in CFO category, it is mentioning KMP automatically. So, if by filing this form, the person will become KMP?
See, my question is only one thing. You know, see, for example, you have to file DIR 12 when you are appointing a KMP. Suppose, say, for example, I am appointing, say, for example, my company paid up capital is only 5 crores. I don't need to have a KMP under 203. I am just simply sitting appointing him as a CFO. I don't even need to file DIR 12. See, DIR 12 question comes only when you are designating him as a KMP. If I am not designating him as a KMP, I don't need to file a DIR 12 at all. Okay, my second question, it is there on the screen, is that can a person have consultancy agreement with fellow subsidiary be appointed as independent director of the company? No, because see, you have to see that 149 subsection 6, who are the independent directors? Okay, so according to me, I don't think that can a person have consultancy agreement with the fellow subsidiary be appointed as independent director? He cannot be appointed as independent director of the company for a subsidiary company. Because it was 149 is restricting it, and you see that the definition of independent director. Yes, Amit. The third question is, what are the immunity, protection, powers and authority of a company secretary as KMP? Amit, your voice is breaking. Okay, now that let me answer this question. What are the immunity, protection, powers and authority of the company secretary as KMP? See, that company secretary as such, as per the act, inherently he is not getting any powers. But definitely, inherently, he's having certain responsibilities. He got the duties also have been spelled out for the first time under the Companies Act 2013. So what he should do is that tomorrow, God forbids, for anything, if he has been issued a show cause notice on the company secretary, his immunity protection is depending upon the whether he has discharged his responsibilities the way he is expected to discharge it. If he is not able to discharge his responsibility the way he is expected and he is lacking in that, definitely he will be held responsible. So he should establish that he is not lacking anywhere as far as the compliances are concerned.
Sir, next question is, what is the difference between the manager and a managing director? I think this has been asked. Yes, sir.
This I have brought very clearly in my presentation itself, that there is a difference between a manager and managing director. As far as the manager is concerned, managing director is concerned, first and foremost thing is he should be a director. He should be on the board of the company, then only he can be appointed as a managing director of the company. As far as the manager is concerned, he may be on the board, he may not be on the board. Second thing is, manager is deriving his powers statutorily, which is not the case with the managing director. Third thing is, manager is having the overall substantial powers on the overall the affairs of organization, which is not the case with the managing director. Managing director is having the powers whatever he has been assigned with or delegated with only. Similarly, a company can have more than one managing director, but very rarely you will have a company with more than two managers. And so these are the primary things, and the presentation what I have made, I will give it to you. You may circulate to all your participants. And whatever the differentiation between the manager and the managing director, I have very clearly brought it under my presentation. Yes, Amit. Amit, if you bring your cursor down, I can see the question. Your voice is breaking. Amit, I'm not able to make out anything because your voice is cracking so much. What I suggest is that if you can just you take up this queries list, from there I can answer the questions. Whatever you have put on the screen, please lift it up.
Sir, if I read up, will you be able to listen, sir? Queries.
No, I'm again the same thing. I think you both have a very bad bandwidth and not able to listen anything. In fact, Amit, this thing is buffering very much. Amit, what you have put on the screen, if you can just take it up. I can see the questions and I can answer. I hope you are able to listen to me properly.
Yes, sir. There is some connectivity issue at my end.
Yeah, doesn't matter what you do is, please take up this, your queries, what you have put on the screen. I can see up to four only. If you take it up, I can answer the questions.
Okay. I will do that.
Please do that. I cannot scroll the document. Somebody has suggested that I can scroll the document, but it is not. Sorry. Yes. Somebody said that. But I can scroll the document. In my view, CFO is no more a KMP as per Companies Amendment Act 2017. Please clarify. No, it is CFO is very much a KMP, ma'am. That Navita, CFO is very much a KMP. Priyanka Bajaj, can a CFO, CEO, private owned company sign the balance sheet even when it is internal designation for the company? What are the consequences of signing the balance sheet and not filing the form? By merely, as I told you, that CFO and CEO is an internal designation of the company, means what I am, Priyanka, you are trying to say is that they are not appointed as KMPs, they are appointed as only CFO and CEO, and you are not filed their form, corresponding forms also. But still, yes, since you have given them the designations, and you may get the balance sheet signed from them also. As far as the responsibility of signing the balance sheet is concerned, let me say that if he is a CFO and a CEO, by merely signing the balance sheet, they are not getting any additional responsibilities. By not signing the balance sheet, they are not getting absolved from any responsibilities. But the only thing is, by signing the balance sheet, what they are doing is they are ensuring that, and they are assuring the stakeholders that all the compliances, whatever are there to be in preparation of the financial statements, are met with. Especially in case of CFO and CEO, they will be definitely held responsible as far as the authenticity of the and accuracy of the financial statements are concerned. As far as company secretary is concerned, several times this question comes up, whether the company secretary will be legally held liable. He has no clue about the balance sheet, but still he is signing the balance sheet. In fact, let me tell you, under the old act, it is the directors and the company secretary only were signing the balance sheet. CFO was not signing at all. In fact, that time we used to ask the regulator several times, we brought it to the notice of the regulators that the person who is preparing and who is responsible for the balance sheet or profit and loss account, he is not signing it. And it is the company secretary who has been asked to sign it. Because the reason for that was under the old act, it is after the directors, it is the only company secretary who got the statutory recognition. The positions who got the statutory recognition, the regulator expected them to sign the balance sheet. And now that CFO and CEO are also having the statutory recognition, they're expected to sign the financial statements. So I repeat that whatever I said, by merely signing, they are not getting any additional responsibilities. Not by signing, they are not absolving from any responsibilities. Whether KMP can be appointed by board resolution in a government company. Government company, that as far as the KMP is concerned, it is the same rules and regulations, whether it is a government company or not. If the government company, if it is not a listed company, then the 10 crores paid up capital is there. If it is a government companies are also listed companies, they are there. Obviously, those companies have to also have the KMP positions. Then Keshav Tiwari, the SR required to be passed in the other company or the company in which he is already a MD. SR means I am expecting shareholder resolution is required to be passed by the other company or which is already an MD. If you are, whatever the question I could understand is like this, you are appointing a managing director of a company as a managing director in some other company, whether that other company has to appoint the managing director by way of a shareholder resolution, answer is yes. You have to, that shareholder's approval is required for appointment as a managing director in the other company. As far as the terms and conditions, remuneration, if any, is there, all those things are to be addressed into. Varnika Jain, what is the paid up share capital? Paid up share capital means there are, as we all know, that share capital is three, four types. One is the authorized capital, that means up to which a company can issue the capital. Issued capital means whatever the company has issued the shares. Subscribed capital means out of the issued capital, whatever is subscribed, that is subscribed capital. And paid up capital means out of the subscribed capital, whatever is paid up. That means I might be having, say, 100 crores authorized capital. I have issued 50 crores. Out of that, only 45 crores is subscribed. And out of the 45 crores, I have asked that for the paid up is only 25 crores. The remaining I have not yet called up. That means my paid up capital is 25 crores. That means 100 crores is authorized capital and 50 crores is the issued capital. Subscribed is 45, paid up is 25. That is how it is determined. It is not coming down further. Amit, if you can help me. Yeah, it is coming down further, yes. What is the next question is that, can an individual, Shagupta Merchant, can a whole-time director can get remuneration from other company? See, whole-time director, according to me, a managing director can be a managing director of two companies. According to me, a whole-time director is to be a whole-time director of only one company. A whole-time director cannot be a whole-time director of another company. But that means he can be a director, but he cannot be a whole-time director of another company. So he cannot get remuneration from the other company. If you say that this question, whether it is clearly came in the act, nowhere in the act as such, it is, this issue is addressed. But the concept of whole-time director itself means he should be in the whole-time employment of the company. So he cannot be a whole-time director in any other company. Unlike managing director or manager, this has not been provided under the act. So what is not provided is not permitted. That is what I view it. So a whole-time director cannot get remuneration from other company. That's what my answer is. And Priyanka Bajaj, can a private limited company appoint a person as CFO as internal designation and appoint CS on the board or vice versa? Since it is an internal, this thing means I presume that section 203 is not applicable to you. The way you want it, you can do it. A company secretary can be on the board of a company. There is absolutely no issue is concerned. A CFO can be on the board of the company and a company secretary can be on the board of the company, but they cannot hold dual position. That means a CFO is a CFO And a CS is a CS, despite the fact they are directors of the company, but that company has to have an MD or a CEO or a manager or a whole-time director separately. You cannot say that these are people are the executive directors, so they are the whole-time directors and they will be a whole-time director KMP as well as CFO, CS, KMP. That will not be permitted. Tirupati Subramanyam, can an individual can be a part-time KMP? This I have already explained to you. If the KMP who is to be appointed under 203, he should be a whole-time KMP and he cannot be a part-time KMP. And as permitted under the Act, a whole-time KMP can be a whole-time KMP of its subsidiary company. According to me, only one more subsidiary company of the company, but some people are interpreting it very loosely that they say that he can be a whole-time KMP of all the subsidiary companies of the company. To that thought, I don't agree with. I hope I could answer your question. Now, Bipin Gupta, how a company secretary as KMP who are in contract basis for a period of 1 year or 2 year will discharge his duties efficiently? Please throw light on this. A company secretary who is the whole-time KMP cannot be on a contract for a period of 1 year or 2 years. If it is a service contract like that, if it is a 1 year service contract or a 2 year service contract, yes, one can be like that also, I don't deny that. But now your question is how he can discharge his duties efficiently. What is the problem? Suppose if I am in the employment and somebody has taken me in the employment for a period of 3 years as a company secretary, until the time whatever I'm going to hold the position, I will do it. So for example, a managing director, he is appointed as a managing director for a period of 5 years. So whatever he could do in 5 years, he is doing it. And similarly, that very rarely it happens that company secretaries are appointed for 1 year employment contract or 2 year employment contract, but I cannot deny that. It may be there in the market like that, but during that period, whatever you are there in the employment, whatever your contractual terms are there, your duties, you have to discharge it during that period. Whatever the prior to your joining and after you are coming out of the company, you will not be held responsible, but during the period, wherever you are there, definitely you will be held responsible for your actions. Akka Bakka, if a KMP is appointed via board resolution, this is the question is not complete. Amit, this seems to be some other this thing is there. You can put it on your screen.
Sir, I will read the other asked by the students. A subsidiary company give company secretary service to holding company by way of service agreement.
Can a subsidiary company?
The question is like, can a company secretary of a subsidiary company become a company secretary of a holding company?
Yeah, see, this question has come up, okay, that means what? Suppose a KMP of the holding company can be a KMP of the subsidiary company. So now the question is in the reverse way, the KMP of a subsidiary company can be the holding company. I will take a liberal interpretation that he can be so. He can be so. In fact, you know, okay, that's
yes, sir, I agree.
In fact, in one or two places, what I have done it also is by that, okay, you ask him to resign from subsidiary company first, appoint him in the holding company, then appoint him in subsidiary company. But subsequently, what we come to a conclusion is not necessarily a subsidiary company's KMP can be a KMP of the holding company also. No problem.
There are many questions on the, I think you referred the secretarial standard 3 and 4. So regarding their applicability and regarding their voluntary nature adoption, can you just give a clarification? I think that will give answers to many of the queries.
Yeah. See, before we go, what is secretarial standard 3 and 4? As I told you, 3 talks about dividend and SS4 deals with board of directors, board's report. And as I told you, that guidance notes are also there. And if somebody asks me whether I have to mandatorily comply with, answer is no, because these are recommendatory as on date, they are not mandatory. What are mandatory? SS1 and SS2 are mandatory. So whether as a company secretary or as a professional, whether I have to comply with SS3 and SS4, before I say that, you have to understand that what is the objectives of SS1 and 2? How that is going to help me? The main objective of SS1 and 2 is that to institutionalize the processes and procedures of secretarial compliances. That means what? A uniform practice will be there across the groups of companies. Suppose, you know, if you work for big groups, you will have n number of companies and you are the group head. You doesn't know that, suppose, for example, in Reliance, we have some 350 plus companies are there. The head of the department will not come to know unless until this kind of standards are there, standard procedures are there. Otherwise, what will happen is every company secretary, we have approximately about 60 to 70 company secretaries are there. Everyone might be acting upon their own. Then where is the uniformity? SS objective is that to establish that uniformity, uniform the procedures. Similarly, the objective of SS also is that wherever there is an ambiguity in the act or wherever the act is silent, to provide some kind of a what's called as an interpretation or a guidance to the professionals. So if you see that, as I mentioned to you, when you are preparing a board's report, the provisions, what you have to brought in, the information, what you have to furnish in the board's report is scattered all through the act and all through the regulations. And it is humanly impossible if anything miss out in the board's report, which is a legal document, is amounting to non-compliance, and the directors will be held responsible. So for that, SS4 is the definitely a good thing, that if you comply with that, never ever a professional should think that whether it is mandatory or non-mandatory, I have to always think it is whether it is to be useful to the company or not. So my advice to everyone is that SS3 and 4 also, please do comply with that. If you are not able to comply to the 100%, at least I expect that 75 to 80% compliance is there for your own benefit.
Thank you, sir. There is one query on section 203, because every company having the prescribed threshold shall have 1, 2, 3 KMPs.
Yeah.
Is it making any difference because they have used the word shall have and they have not used the word shall appoint?
See, this also, if you see my presentation in the very beginning itself, I said that what is the difference between shall have and shall appoint? Shall appoint, had they used the word shall appoint, means necessarily the KMP should be in the employment of the company. But they have not used the word shall appoint, they have used the word shall have. Shall have means I can outsource it. I don't need to employ a person for that. I can take a person on secondment basis also, or I can take a person on contractual basis. Suppose I can appoint a company secretary as a consultant to me. He don't need to be an employment of the company. A consultant, I can appoint him as a KMP. So that is the difference between that. That is the only reason what we could do is that in a group of companies, when we have that so many companies which require mandatory appointment of KMPs, and we have the, suppose for example, there are companies which are having paid up capital and all, because they might be asset-based companies, they don't have any operations as such. So they may not be able to afford the salaries of the employees. So what we do is that we appoint normally all these company secretaries in the parent company, and we depute them on the secondment basis to the other companies wherever statutorily the KMP is required. And we assign that person with the responsibility to take the secretarial affairs of that company in addition to that parent company's responsibility, whatever we assign. That is the reason for that.
Right, sir. Then one question is on the dividend, whether other comprehensive income as disclosed under the Ind AS can be utilized for the purpose of declaration of dividend?
In the other comprehensive income also, you have different components. The components which are available, which are falling under the definition of free reserves only, are available. Otherwise, no, it is not available.
Absolutely. Then another question is on the dividend. Is the entire amount of free reserve can be used for the declaration of dividend? I think you covered very well in the presentation itself. This can be skipped.
You have various restrictions are there. That restrictions, you have to see that.
Yes. Can a private company with a paid up capital of rupees 2 crore appoint independent director? If so appointed, is it a violation of Companies Act 2013?
A company can appoint independent director. No, there is no issue.
Yes. Can you give a practical example in a company with respect to the manager and MD? This is another repeat question.
As I told you that you cannot have a manager and managing director simultaneously. This is prohibited under section 196.
Correct. There is one more question on the KMP. Can a same person hold more than one KMP position, like CFO and CS can be one person?
It cannot be.
He has quoted some company example, the legal position as explained by Sudhakarji is it cannot be the same person. So legal position is like that.
Initially, Amit, there was a confusion, but it is clearly established now. If any company is having like that CFO come CS, that particular person might be enjoying the designation, but he might have filed the KMP position for either CFO or CS. There might be another person for the other particular position. It may be there like that. So you cannot just come to a conclusion that company is violating it, the company is not violating it. A company might have been having a person CFO come CS, okay, but he might have filed his DIR-12 as a company secretary. Another person might be there who has filed the KMP position as CFO. We have to see the facts and figures. If he is doing it, it is a violation there.
Sir, another question is, what is the meaning of executive director?
Executive director means it is simply sitting a working director. You say, for example, you know that the whole time
directors.
Yes, all whole time directors are executive directors.
Correct. So another question is from Dr. K.S. Ravichandran, sir. He is asking whether the board can cancel interim dividend declared.
Yes, board can cancel interim dividend declared, as I told you that. Board, once interim dividend is declared, it is a debt. Okay. So according to me, once an interim board is declared the interim dividend, it should not be cancelled unless until it wants to improvise that. See, for example, recently one company, what it has done is that it has declared a dividend and subsequently they have cancelled the dividend because they could not hold the AGM. They came with an interim dividend. So according to me, once interim dividend is declared, it should not be cancelled. It is a debt.
Thank you so much. I think by and large, we have covered most of the queries. Many queries are repetitive also. So it's already 10:10. So we can close the session for the today. And thank you so much for your enlightenment on the three vast subject, including dividend, including investor education protection fund and KMP. All three require a separate session for the deliberation, but in last 3 hours you have very aptly highlighted all the important provisions, and we have got very good feedback from the participants that the session was very useful, and we should continue to have similar session again, and demand is that should have a separate session for dividend and KMP, one full session for dividend and one full session for KMP. So maybe we'll request university people to take care of the same and organize a separate program for the same. So for the participants, we just have one announcement. We have shared one Google form for your feedback. Kindly fill that form and submit it by end of the today. And those people who have experienced any difficulty on the login in the WebEx, we will be sharing the invitation link. Kindly register again, and we will be able to log in on the WebEx also. Otherwise, alternatively, the YouTube link is very well working. The sessions will go all live for the next 15 days. Tomorrow we have a session on role of a communicatory role of a lawyer in a corporate field, and what is the scope for the arbitration, mediation, conciliation, and how the budding lawyer should prepare themselves for entering and making a career into this particular aspect. And the speaker is again very renowned from the ACC Limited. Mr. Rajiv Chaubey will be taking that particular session. And the session link will remain same, YouTube link will remain same. You are not required to do fresh registration. Only thing, if you are not able to make a login, we will be sending the invitation again. Kindly register again. You will be able to make the login. There was some issue, but that issue has now been resolved. So with this, I will request Vishalakshi ma'am to say something about the today's session as a feedback and any guidance that she want to give for the further program for the student or then.
Sir, thanks a lot. You have explained in crystal clear words, and all the provision scope of these topics is fully covered. And this session is useful to our law graduates. Sir, I am also thinking to plan a separate program inviting you and the resource persons in future also. Sir, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot on behalf of me and on behalf of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University. And we will be grateful to you, sir. Namaste.
I also take this opportunity again to thank you, Dr. Vishalakshi and Amit, as well as Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University for inviting me and spending 3 minutes with all of you. Thanks once again. Anytime I am of some resource to you, you can back up on me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And just one more last announcement, because many people have asked whether this PPT will be shared or not. So I will request Sudhakar sir to share the PPT. We will upload it on the YouTube link also, and it will be shared to all the participants. It will be uploaded on the RML website also. So from that website also, you can get that PPT. So PPT and videos are not a problem. All the PPTs and videos will be available. The purpose of arranging these programs is to have your live interaction with the resource person. PPTs are otherwise abundant number of PPTs are available on the Google. So you can download from there, but those will not be really help you unless and until you understand the concept. But nonetheless, as promised, we will be sharing the PPT by end of the day on the link itself. I will request Sudhakar sir to just send a copy by email to me. I will request RML people to upload the same.
I will certainly send you it. I will do that.
Thank you all the participants once again for joining this program and your overwhelming response. We'll keep holding such sessions continuously with the association with Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia University. See you tomorrow sharp at 7 a.m. in the morning with another session on this particular series. Have a good day.
Thank you very much and God bless you all.
Thank you so much.
Sudhakar garu namaste nandi further.
Namaskar amma, namaskar. I am very happy that you are from DNR College. I was also of the same. Tappakunda me na touch lo undandi, na number presentation lo undadi, me note chesukondi dani, me number kuda na.
Atlane sir, atlane.
Thank you very much amma.
Namaste.
Thank you sir, thank you ma'am.
Thank you Abhay, thank you very much, bye.